lover fools, and he never took no lip. And after serial livers, area, and then he came and saw some shit he said.
What up, guys? Welcome. Here we go. And that shit again. What up? Hello. Hi. It does sound like Otis. We opened up with a Little Richard song because Little Richard died, and that was sad, and I always liked me some Little Richard. And, you know, when you're friends with Fancy Ray and he puts out a big heartfelt, this is the Little Richard tune to sing to or, like listen to. You listen to him, you know? So that was Little Richard's I Don't Know What You Got, But It Got Me. So that was, that was absolutely Little Richard. Get fucked. The best part is Taxes Theft is in here like fucking, oh, I love me some Otis. Like, that wasn't Otis, bro. Welcome. Here we are. We're doing it again. We've gotten along. For those of you that weren't with us last night, I'm sorry that I didn't broadcast at the normal time. I should have said something. That's on me. But you know what? Don't care, I guess. I don't know. It was fucking UFC, man. I don't know what you guys want from me. This mic doesn't seem like it's responding. Do I seem soft to you guys? Is that... I feel like this mic is acting weird. No, maybe not. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm acting weird. Hold on. We gotta... The levels are all out of... They're crazy, man. Yeah, there we go. Let's see if that's better. Check, check, check. Sibilance. Sibilance. I'm gonna go into the microphone settings and see what's going on. Whatever. Yeah, we got a great show for you tonight. Dude, Justin is better than he thought he was. Yeah, Taxes Theft. Are you a big MMA guy? You are, right? Yeah, I was confused as fuck last night. How were the fights? Yeah, so what happened last night was I was going to do something before the show, and I ended up not doing that, and that's kind of on me, and I'm sorry. And then I also, at the same time, decided I was going to watch the fights. So I watched the fights. They were real good. Real good fights last night. We're going to talk... some MMA stuff. You know what? We're going to call Brady. Where are you? I'm going to call you, Brady. You'll be the first guy on here. What the fuck? Send me a message, Brady. I have too many Brady friends and I can't type in Taxes Theft. I mean, I guess I could. Let me find. This one. Yeah, there you are. Never mind. I found you, motherfucker. I found you. Boom. Here we go.
Hello.
Hello. How are you?
Yeah. Good. It makes my dog bark whenever I do that.
Oh, does it?
I should put on headphones. Do you hear me all right? Or is it
yeah, you're okay, I guess. I mean, yeah, put on some fucking headphones, goddammit.
Yeah, let me put on headphones.
Yeah, put on some fucking headphones.
Son of a bitch.
I know.
Son of a bitch.
Put on some fucking headphones.
Son of a bitch.
I know. You can keep saying
it. It's all good, dude.
It doesn't make
it's
you
all good.
Putting on headphones any less true. Get them on there.
Absolutely
on
right.
Goddamn
man.
Headphones.
I gotta put them in my ears.
As I enlarge
first.
This picture of you with a fucking Christmas tree.
Oh, yeah, dude, I'm holding it up. I chopped that bitch down.
Damn.
Yeah, I chopped it down and I held it up. I'm strong. It's actually not that big, it's not that heavy. All right, you hear me?
Yeah.
All right, is this better?
Yeah, it's way better.
All right, cool. Cool, cool. So what's up, dude? How about them fights, man?
How about them fucking fights, man?
Dude, those fights were fucking awesome. Nico Price and Luque, holy shit, dude. Like, dad, I was yelling at the TV, man. Like, I was like, I was so into it.
I'm pretty sure I almost had a heart attack during the Ferguson-Gaethje fight. That's one of the best fights I've ever seen.
That was amazing. I could not believe, like, Justin fought.
Oh, he's zonking out.
My mom was just trying to call me.
Oh, is that what that was?
Yeah.
You can
That was weird, though, because it normally...
Hold on.
This thing normally doesn't play music. Yeah, that was weird. I think that came from your end.
It might have. My shit's being weird right now. I don't know what the fuck is happening. My mic is really soft, but the other one's fine. I don't know what the fuck is happening. You get all these fucking audio settings through all these different programs. Yeah, come out of the forest.
Hey,
can you guys hear me now?
Hold on, you ought to put up that Trojan horse picture because I got that on my profile for a
check,
reason.
Check. And there we go. There we go. Now I fucking got it. I fixed it. Now you can fucking hear me. Gonna be some problems now, motherfucker. Yeah.
Who,
fixed
me?
It. No,
I can hear you the whole time. What are you talking about?
You are fine. It's the meter going into the other one. It's the whole audio settings, man. It's not you. You can hear shit. Like, I'm going to cough and burp and shit that they won't hear because I can hit the mute button, but you will hear it because you're not in through that line.
Okay.
Like that. They couldn't hear that.
And they didn't hear that.
Right.
But they can hear me the whole time.
Correct.
So you're not muting me at all if I were to go... Wah, 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 wah.
I mean, I can, but you just have to let me know if you're going to cough.
Oh, okay. Or if I have to piss.
Yeah, just say, like, piss, and then...
All right. Justin, dude.
Yeah.
Fart. So smart. So smart. Like, this new fucking patient, Justin Gaethje, is amazing. Because... He's still throwing everything with heat. He's still throwing like a truck, man. I don't know how Tony was able to take that shit, dude. Like, I kind of felt bad for him, you know, before they stopped the fight.
Yeah,
are you still there?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think, like, because when Tony cracked him in round two, I thought that was a big, like, going to be a weird moment for everybody, you know? But
– yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I picked Gaethje, but I didn't think Gaethje would win a round five knockout. You know what I mean? Like, that's not something I saw.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
and
that's
so
like
cool
the,
to see him get precise and stuff. And I mean, I don't know, man. I think I'm gonna pick him to beat Khabib,
new,
dude. I love me some Justin.
He presents a really unique challenge, honestly, because
he's also a fucking collegiate wrestler.
I've got Justin over Khabib, I think, right now. I do. And which is crazy because I don't think anybody can beat Khabib.
Maybe.
I don't.
I mean, here's the thing. Like, dude, Justin does everything right. Like, first off, he picked apart Ferguson. He picked him apart. And then
dude,
he throws the interim belt on the ground.
He made the boogeyman look like a fucking person.
Yeah, because he ain't the boogeyman for Justin. Nobody's the boogeyman. He just get it. We're literally seeing, like, every now and again in MMA, you get these cycles where you get to be, like, you get to see these guys coming back around, you know, greats that you looked up to and shit like that. And what we're witnessing is the fucking rebirth, if you will, the, like, phoenix moment of, like, reincarnation of Robbie Lawler. Like, we got Robbie Lawler back.
Yeah, and it's the same thing. It's the same thing with Justin right now.
That's what I'm saying. Like, Justin.
Like, Justin is what's cool about Justin, though, like, he fucking admits, like, he says, okay, like, I never had a problem with just going in and fucking banging with dudes and not giving a shit about getting hit. And now, you know, I have to worry more about getting hit because I experienced that twice. Like, two guys, I had too much fun in there, and two guys, they hit me in the right spot, and I went out. I don't want to do that again. So now I'm worrying about, like, not getting hit because, you know, now that's, like, the thing that has to change for me to win, you know? And it's just, like, fucking nuts, dude. This dude's mindset.
Well, and the way, like, again, to me, the way he slams that interim belt, I love that shit. I love that shit. That's, like, my favorite.
That was cool. And Joe Rogan said, well, what'd you do that for? I'm going to wait for the other one.
He said, I'm going to wait for the real one.
Yeah, I'm going to wait for the real one. Yeah, I want the real
one. And then at the post-conference, he's holding it and saying it's cool and everything, but it's like, you get that awesome show of, like, fuck this interim title, and then you're like, no, I do respect it. That's cool, but that's not what I'm here for.
And everybody knows that. Like, with him, he's such a genuine guy, dude, and he's so humble. Like, everybody knows he's a competitor to the top, and that's why I got him, like, I mean, I don't think Khabib has ever faced anybody like Justin. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
because everybody says that the other way around. right?
Well, I think that's exactly it. And I've been a huge Justin Gaethje fan since he came over, because I followed him when he was doing that World Series of Fighting, because he fucking, like,
that motherfucker was like crazy on World Series of Fighting.
Well, it was nuts. It was like you couldn't get a fight. You couldn't get a fight out of 30 seconds from that dude ever.
No. And he would put his hands up, but if you noticed, he would put his hands up and let people punch him, but he would always dip down his forehead. So these motherfuckers are just punching his forehead.
Yeah, he's trying to break their hands.
You know how hard that is? Yeah, you know how hard that is? Like, the forehead is way harder than the hand.
Yeah, no, and I agree.
He was doing that. Like, then that was all strategy. And he knows what he's doing. Division, what, one wrestler? I mean, he's amazing. No takedown attempts at all. And he knows it. Like, he knows he can do that. But he's like, no, fuck that. I want to entertain people. I want to put max effort into this, into what I like doing, and have fun, you know? And it's just like, how can you not fucking respect and be a fan of that?
Yeah, I mean, it's there's nothing. Me and Tom did a post show last night late after the fights, and it was one of those things.
I watched it today, dude. I fell asleep last night, but I watched it today. It was really good.
Yeah, I mean, I'm gonna start doing that afterwards anyways, because I'm right here anyways. I might as well, you know?
Cool.
And, like, especially
good. That'd be fucking awesome, man.
Yeah, I mean, like, whatever. They're great, you know? And the whole idea is just it's – with Justin Gaethje, you can't like MMA and not like him, because he's exactly what you want out of an MMA guy. He's game to fight. He's got that mindset. He's got an all-time great coach, which he's listening to. And one of the things that I love the best about him is, you know, he – like, anybody that wasn't him would have looked at those two losses and just thought, oh, I can't hack it in the UFC. He gets two losses, and he's like, oh, yeah, okay, I need to come at this differently. I'm doing this, you know, like – and you look at those losses, and it's like one of them is to Dustin Poirier, right? Like, there's no shame. Yeah. Dustin Poirier is a world beater.
That's my hometown boy, dude.
Well, that's what I'm saying, but that dude is a world beater. There's no shame in that.
That motherfucker's badass, man. No, there's no – and Eddie Alvarez, there's no shame in that either.
But the thing about the Eddie Alvarez fight is that Gaethje had him. Like, he was beating his ass. And then he got careless and got overzealous, and Eddie snapped awake and did everyday Eddie shit. That's what he does.
And the awesome part about that is that Justin is aware of that. Like, Gaethje is aware of that.
The thing about Tony Ferguson that I kept saying,
I had too much fun.
I kept telling everybody this with Tony, man.
I'm overzealous. So.
Everybody talks about Tony Ferguson, but I'm telling you, and I went over it last night on the show. I've been saying this dude is overrated from day one. You go over and you look at his record. Take him out of the equation. Find the names, because you can't. You can't find anybody in their prime that he rolled through except for Pettis, who was still a unanimous decision. And then
that's a good point, man.
And like, I mean, Cowboy is really,
what about Tony versus Dos Anjos after Dos Anjos lost the title?
You can make the argument that after he lost the title, Dos Anjos is not elite.
That's true.
I mean, maybe that's what I'm saying, is he never got anybody in his prime, you know? And that's what, like, because, I mean, like, this is, I went over this last night, but we'll go over it real quick here, is that, like, if you look at the boogeyman stuff, right, you have a win over Cerrone, where he was beating his ass, that's fine, but Cerrone is older and, like, he's more vulnerable than he used to be. You have Anthony Pettis, who broke his hand, like, that's not, I mean... He was in that fight till he broke his hand. Like, they'd probably still be fighting. And then again, you go down. But from there on, you have Kevin Lee. Who the fuck cares about Kevin Lee? Rafael Dos Anjos. Who gives a shit? Venata. Who cares? Right. Edson Barbosa's good. I mean, that was 2015.
Yeah, true.
You know,
I talk to my cousin all the time, and we were talking about how why Poirier and Ferguson never fought. Because I feel like they both kind of came up on a parallel trajectory.
They were in different weight classes for a long time. Poirier spent most of his career weight class down.
Well, whenever he came back up to 155, though, I mean, like, he fought Gaethje. I mean,
no. So when Poirier went up, right? He was down lower than when Tony was ascending. And then Tony got injured and Poirier hopscotched him, and they were never aligned in the rankings. I think now is the time for Poirier to fight Ferguson. I think that's the fight to make.
Yeah, that's a great fight, dude.
Yeah.
That's a great fight.
Yeah.
Because, like, you get to see – because Poirier is not just going to go out, and he's very aggressive.
Yeah.
And I think this whole time that was a great fight, right? And That could be a better fight than Tony versus Khabib. Because to be honest with you, I had Khabib beating Tony anyway.
I mean, like, I had Khabib beating Tony, but I think I have Justin beating Khabib. I honestly do, and I'm
right there with you on that one.
Because my big question with Gaethje is like, what's gonna happen in the fourth round when he's fighting this attrition? Does he melt? But he made the boogeyman look like a bitch.
He did, bro. Like, no one's made Tony look like that in a fight at all.
Right.
And I love the part, okay, you love the part where he threw down the belt. I love the part on the press, post-fight presser where Justin said, I look pretty good, right? I mean, come on, look at me. Yeah. I look pretty good, right, after fighting Tony Ferguson?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And think about, Tony Ferguson wasn't even there for a post-fight presser, dude. That motherfucker was in a hospital.
Yeah, he was.
The boogeyman was in a hospital after this shit.
Yeah, I mean, so, that's Justin, a good point. Yeah,
and Justin looked good, dude.
Yeah,
Justin looked like he only got hit a few times. Like, it's like,
although his hand looked super gnarly in that post conference interview.
His hand was fucked up. Yeah, like,
did you see him pop his finger back into joint while Rogan was interviewing him?
Yes.
Like,
yes.
That was hilarious.
But dude, how savage is he? Like, he's just, and he's so humble about it. He's like, oh yeah, oh, gotta pop my finger back in. No big deal. Like, he didn't give a fuck. Like, this dude is, Justin is, he's cool, man. He's a good guy. Like, I could see just, like, hanging out with him and, like, having some beers. And then some dude talks shit, and it's like, Justin, you want to go fight him? No, Justin, leave him alone. Like,
yeah, fuck him. You know what I mean?
Like, no, Justin, no. No, don't. Like, yeah.
And that's the thing about it that was like, I loved, that was one of my favorite things was like, because there was no crowd, you could hear what they say. And he walks over and Ferguson pushes him off and you hear Gaethje go, hey man, you're going to get nowhere being an asshole.
You're going to get nowhere being an asshole. Like, that should be a Justin Gaethje t-shirt,
yeah,
man.
You get nowhere. And I just, I love, you know, I've always loved Gaethje. It's the same reason why I love Cowboy.
It's just amazing.
I love those guys that are great in the ring, but then you talk to them and they're honest about when they're scared or when something didn't add up or something. You know, like he was talking about Ferguson and they're like, well, do you think you can, like, is it ideal to fight him with this short notice? And he goes, no, it's not ideal. He goes, and I don't want to, but I'm a prize fighter fighting for money.
Okay. And then meanwhile, and you're right, but then meanwhile, you got Ferguson talking about, I'm a contract killer in there. I go in there and I'm going to kill. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a contract killer. He's got the baseball. He's got the whole setup and the get up. And he's – so I feel like this was way two different dynamics of, like, promotion with this one. Because think about the way that Tony promoted the fight with Khabib during that press conference, dude. Like, Tony was just full heel.
Yeah.
Being a dick face, too. Like, on purpose.
Well, that's what
you
he
know
does.
What I mean? It was awesome. I thought it was awesome.
Yeah.
He had a baseball – like, and that was cool as shit. And the baseball actually, like, goes back to,
although it's going to be really
being
funny
really
now,
good at, like, other sports.
But, yeah, but okay.
And now,
but listen
right,
to me, listen
is.
To me,
it's
listen,
be
me
a whole
listen
thing.
To me though. Like,
what?
You can't be rolling a baseball down a hallway during a pandemic. Like, do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can't just be rolling it down a hot. Like, he literally rolled this baseball in one of the embeddeds down a hallway of a hotel. Picked it up and put it against his face. So when you read in 2 weeks that everybody in the UFC has corona and we don't get any more fight sports, know that it was because of his fucking baseball.
I mean, Tony fucking Ferguson's baseball.
Yeah.
Apology.
Man, fuck
except
that
dude. No.
Yeah.
No.
I mean, I don't care. I won money betting against him. I told everybody. I told
There's
you guys
a lot
here that he was going to win.
Tony fans, dude.
Yeah.
And I like Tony for, like, for who he is.
Speak of the fucking devil. That was awesome. So I go, yeah, I won money betting on Gaethje. And then JBTV subscribed to me. Him and I put a bet out where if he lost, he had to subscribe to my channel. If I lost, I had to sub to his.
Oh, snap. So
and he hit subscribe right as I was talking about it. That was well fucking
nice.
Played, JB. Well done. Oh, my
very
God. That
nice.
Was, that
yeah,
was really funny.
Dude. That's fucking awesome. That's fucking awesome.
Oh. Oh, that's great. Yeah, no, that was JB. Fucking awesome fights, right? It's going to take a sec. Shit slag. That was so funny. Oh, my
yeah,
God.
It's all good. Dude, awesome fight. So, yeah, we talked about Nico and Vincenzo. And, okay, my lull, I feel like the biggest lull was Carl Esparza and Michelle Waterson. Like, just talking about a lull in the fights, you know, because we had, like, this up, high game going, fucking action-packed, and then these two chicks come in, and they're, like, standing so far apart from each other, just throwing feints.
Sure.
And I'm like, yeah. Come on, girls. Because they're both savages, you know?
All right, well, here, I gotta cut you loose because my other guy's coming in. We got a bunch of MMA people coming, too. So thanks for going over it with me.
Hey, Corey, thanks for calling me, man. Look, I'm going to let you go, and I'm going to keep on watching the show, my man.
All right, buddy. Talk to you later.
All right, man. Hey, fans, fuck y'all. No, I'm just playing.
Attaboy. No, that's what. No, don't back away from it. Slap him. Full heel mode or don't heel at all, bro.
I love everybody. I love everybody,
I hate
man.
This. Now fuck you got to go. Now you got to go.
Hey, fuck you. Have a nice day.
Oh, God, it's just so good. It's so good. That was Brady. Yeah, here we go. Hold on. Chris is on. There. Boom. All right. I don't fucking know. Let's see what happens here. All right, let's do it again. It's always funny with people who, hi. Here we go. Done. Boom.
Hey.
Hey, what up, buddy?
Let's see. Okay.
Yeah, you're doing good. You sound good.
All right.
Welcome welcome to our day three of fight reviews.
Are we live?
Yeah, oh yeah, we're live. Oh, why don't you tell the people who you are?
My name's Chris Burns. I'm a podcast host with you, a referee and licensed judge.
You're way less animated when you're trying to keep it cool at work.
No, I'm just trying to read some of the stuff too. I was just looking at the junkie right now to see some of the headlines coming out. But
how about my boy Gaethje, who I not only picked but won money and some bets on, baby.
Jumping right into the deep end right away, huh?
Oh yeah, dude. That's all I do, bro. I don't even know how to swim in the shallow end.
There's so much going on in this card, though. Jeez, what's not to talk about on here?
Who do you think has better jiu-jitsu, Verdum or the coronavirus?
Well, I think if it was Jacare coronavirus, I'm giving coronavirus.
No, I'm just I was trying to get a measuring stick to pit it against Jacare.
Oh, yeah. Verdum looked pretty bad, actually, yesterday. I don't know if he was gassed, he looked fat, and then he was just missing some pretty basic jiu-jitsu stuff and –
yeah.
Missing a lot of options.
I think what happened was I know Dominic will say there's no ring rust, but I mean, I really think that was a ring rust scenario because, like, he definitely looked like he was getting back in. But what about Olenek? Like, how did he, like, that's the most in shape I've ever seen him.
Yeah. Yeah. He looked.
Usually he comes in there like a guy who's, like, cosplaying a panda.
Yeah. But, you know, in all fairness, he did look good yesterday and he got a win, but he barely squeaked out a win against the worst Verdum we've seen.
Well, so far, I mean, I feel like the worst Verdum we're going to see is every Verdum we see now that he's not allowed to use steroids.
Yeah, but I mean, but to speak to Olenek, to discredit him a little, I guess, he squeaked away a split decision against a really garbage Verdum.
Yeah.
That doesn't bode well for him in the future.
Remember when I thought he was going to be the GOAT?
Yep.
I don't like rubbing my nose in my mistakes, but man, but he did make the championship belt though. I mean, like I call that. I just like that level of jiu-jitsu, that level of striking should have achieved more. I just feel like it should. Mm-hmm.
And for the names, for the people he's taken out and stuff, and a former champ, right. Should have looked a lot better.
And like the dude that actually had the win in Fedor when Fedor was still pretty much in his prime.
He hadn't been beaten at that point.
Yeah, I mean, he was still in the tail end of his prime, but yeah, because he hadn't been beaten, he was still in his prime. That's why I say it like that.
The best jiu-jitsu in a long time, Bryce Mitchell. That boy has been doing some speakeasy, secret rolls for sure. You see all those twister attempts?
Yeah.
He's trying to show off for Eddie Bravo because Eddie Bravo is there.
Yeah, I feel like that was actually the case with a lot of people.
That they were trying to show off for Eddie Bravo? I think you're giving Eddie a little too much credit there. But
I don't know, man.
Bryce looked good. You know, the only judge who got that fight right, though, was the judge who gave it all 10-8s.
Yeah.
What round could you have given Rosa?
You know me. I love going after the judges. Like, honestly, what fight were you watching? Like, I know you like to defend it, but, like, what fight were you watching?
Me?
No, them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It should be all 10-8s. It should have been three 10-8s.
I mean, I think it's all 10-9. No. I mean, whatever. But, clearly it should have been unanimous. Like, what the fuck is that?
It was a unanimous decision.
Well, all right, then.
30-25, 30-24. But I'm saying the only one who got it right was the one who gave it all 10-8s. There was no 10-9 rounds in that one.
Yeah, I mean, it was just absolute dominant. I don't – is that the equivalent of what a 10-8 round is then? Because those are pretty timid 10-8s.
Again, well, that's what makes it really impressive is that with very little striking, he still shows by the metrics he should have three 10-8s. I don't know Florida if they're following the new guidelines or if they're still under the old guidelines. But according to the new guidelines – it's domination first, and then duration and domination. Now, we went over this on the podcast, but if you fill up two of those brackets, you get a 10-8 round at least. Okay?
Yeah, minimum.
So if you have – and Bryce Mitchell had dominated the entire fight bell to bell every round for duration, and it was entirely domination since it was entirely his offensive for all 15 minutes. He maxed out duration and domination the entire time. How does he not get 10-8 rounds the entire time?
Yeah, I mean, that's fair.
So it should have been a historical 10-8 because it should have said, this is the first time only X amount of punches have been thrown in a 10-8, in three 10-8 rounds. Anyways, just that's a little bit of the official side. I would like to get geeked out about that, but maybe next time, Bryce.
Do you think Nico Price's stock goes up despite his loss?
Yeah, it was a good fight. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, it's still sports entertainment. So Nico Price gets to stick around for a few, probably. I think Michelle Watterson, she just it that.
I thought she won that fight. Man.
Yeah, I think she did too. That point style karate though, that doesn't have enough. It doesn't have enough impact. It seems like sometimes to really sway the judges.
Is that just because it's not doing enough damage?
Yeah, yeah. You know, like Wonder Boy kind of had that thing going. I mean, Wonder Boy's had some knockouts, but
yeah.
A lot of his strikes kind of get unnoticed because they're point strikes, you know?
Sure.
Pettis Cerrone, man, watching your dad's fight.
Yeah. It's like watching your dad fight like your older brother, and you're just like, I don't care about this. You guys are both real old.
Yeah, you guys should have matured out a long time ago.
But, would you guys be watching reruns of Coach somewhere?
I thought they looked good. I think Anthony Pettis is a little ridiculous to say that he's the best he's ever been, better than when he's in championship shape or whatever. I think he needs to be more realistic that he's going to be doing superstar fights from now on.
Yeah, he's a gatekeeper.
Yep. That first fight of the main card, I don't even care about.
Which one was – oh, Hardy? Who cares?
Yeah.
Hey, Hardy barely managed to eat the lunch of the guy that was there to feed him. Who cares? Like, why are they feeding him so much? Just let him fight Derek Lewis. Derek Lewis wants to fight him.
Yeah, Derek Lewis hates a woman beater.
Derek Lewis loves beating up people that beat women. He loves it. That's like his thing.
You know, and they fed Hardy another 1-1 UFC fighter.
That's what I'm saying. They've been like every fight this dude is just getting fed because I think that they're getting more watching because of how much people hate him.
Yeah, and I think maybe there's a thought if enough time passes, they can kind of be like, what woman beating? This is Greg Hardy, former NFL star. They're kind of might be hoping the public forgets.
Yeah.
Calvin,
what do you think of Calvin GSP Cutter? Going to the Hall of Fame? That's pretty controversial, right? Like, I don't know if he belongs there.
Who?
GSP?
Never heard of her.
Yeah, right? That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't follow a lot of bantamweight women, but I mean, like, you just got to follow them.
Try to do something that impacts the game, you know, be memorable somehow. Try to set a record or something. Jeez.
Right. Like, I mean, it's like, yeah, you want me to remember you? Set a record. Defend a belt or something. Maybe defend two.
Yeah. Calvin Cutter, Jeremy Stevens. Jeremy Stevens, is he done?
No. No, Little Heathen. Little Heathen is not being done by missing weight by 5 pounds. That's not happening.
And they get his lights shut out and... He's old, man. He's got, what, 33 fights now? He said 6.5 hours of fight time?
I mean, yeah, a lot of, but he's also fighting at, like, the midget weight classes.
Yeah.
Like, but I mean, still, aside from him and John Dodson, who really throws flame in those weight classes?
God, I hate that Stevens killed the career at Doho Choi.
Damn. Yeah, I do miss Korean Superboy for sure. It's like you said, though, don't get excited about Koreans. They'll just let you down.
Yeah, that's what I tell my wife every night.
Tom Chilstrom says, tell Chris to stop saying peas because his phone sucks and the speakers pop.
Oh, okay. Sorry, Tom Chilstrom.
Chilstrom. Sorry, Top Chilstrom.
Francis Ngannou. Rosenstruck.
Oh, man. You know, I have to just say this, and I have to recant all of my ways. This keeps happening to me with Ngannou. Like, I know who he is. Like, I know who he is. I was a big advocate for him when he was on his way up the first time, right?
Yeah.
And then, like, I don't know what it is, but I just keep picking people against him. Like, in my head, I'm like, yeah, but Curtis Blaydes has improved a lot. He's really going to shut his lights out this time. And, like, with Rosenstruck, it's like, well, he fucking killed Overeem's jaw. And then he called out Ngannou when nobody wants to fight him. Like, that's baller. And then it's just, I mean, it's the ugliest punching style ever. But the guy, I mean, the guy's hands are made of anvils.
Oh, yeah. It's not a pretty style. It's, let me see how many cans of Dinty Moore soup I can throw at your head. And one of them hit. One of them will land.
Prop me up beside the jukebox, says, tell Tom to shut the fuck up.
I don't even know you could swear on this show.
Yeah, we can fucking swear.
Oh, sweet. Fuck yeah.
This is God's radio now, motherfucker.
Yeah, I think Ngannou is going to, I mean, he's going to go up again, but, you know,
it doesn't
again,
matter, though, because, like, I think, like, if Cormier wins, he's fighting Jones and then retire. Like, I honestly believe that Cormier is going to fight Jones again, but I think that that's the last fight. He's fighting Stipe, he's fighting Jones, that's a career.
Yeah, I wouldn't come back. I wouldn't extend it one extra one just to fight Francis.
Right. Well, but like the thing is too with DC is if he beats Stipe, like he could just like he could if Jones doesn't want to fight him, he'll walk away because he already got the belt again. And I mean DC is already. I mean he's one of my favorites. He's already going to go down in history as one of the goats. I mean,
yeah, you know, and with Stipe looking like his hand surgeries and him being inactive for so long. Ngannou might just find himself in a softer heavyweight division where his big hands and lack of grappling skills don't matter, and his big hands can carry him to the
well. And I mean, there's no way that Cormier loosening up Stipe doesn't help him if Stipe wins, and that, you know what I mean. And if DC wins, he's gone. And then the thing that's crazy about Ngannou is like, and I didn't realize this till I went over his record. If you look down the heavyweights, he's beat them all. Like, he lost to Stipe. He hasn't fought DC. Every single person below him of any kind of matter, he's already beat. In Blade's case, he beat twice.
Including JDS. Yep. All right. Henry Cejudo, Dominic Cruz.
So I wanted to talk to you about this one specifically. I fucking hated that stoppage, and you knew that I would.
A lot of people did.
But here's what I'll say. Here's what I'll say, and I think this is your influence rubbing off on me on the side of the ref. First off, it's interesting that that same ref also fucked up the eye poke against Pettis. Like, I think sometimes not having a crowd can fuck up with the ref's rhythm as well.
Oh, yeah. There's crowd reactions to stuff that
so
sometimes,
I'm not – it's like Stevens missing weight. I think that this is at a weird push for anybody where I don't think any of these losses – one, they're some of the best fights I've seen all year. Easily the best fight card of the year. Easily.
Yeah.
And I mean, we all knew that because they were cramming basically 2 months of contracted fights into. I mean, you're looking at this fight like most of the things on the prelim could have headlined their own fight night.
Yep.
And then, yep. Like, the thing is with this ref, is like, if he had called it off when Dominic was face down and looking like a fish, maybe. But my problem, and I know you're going to say they don't realize that or whatever, but it's like the dude was getting up and there was 2 seconds left in the round.
Yep.
Like 2 seconds. I mean, the official time is fucking 4:58. Like it was,
yeah.
It was 2 seconds left. And when he turned it over and he was literally getting up. And this is what I'm talking about with you and I talked about. I forget who it was, but you thought it was fine or whatever. But it's like at some point, we have to let them get a chance because I don't know how you get your balance back and roll over to your feet without taking shots. And specifically at that weight class, are those shots hurting them? No, I don't believe so. Was Henry hurting him with damage? No, he wasn't. Did the knee hurt him? Yes. The knee to the face stunned him. I don't believe the flailing punches of fucking what? 135? Calm down.
You know, so the first and only job really of the ref, is to enforce the rules, but the primary job before anything else is the safety of the fighter. That has to be understood when taking considerations of when a ref is stopping a fight. And the second thing to consider for a lot of people is the ref's human. You know, in a machine could have probably thought there's 2 seconds left, there's, you know, under 10, 30 seconds left or whatever. When I reset them for this,
from time to time.
Yeah, I realize the time was short. But, you know, he forgets things. You're caught up in the moment, the heat of the action.
You fucking ref apologist.
Oh, shit!
And he's got to protect the fighter. If he thinks the fighter's going to take long-lasting damage from these shots...
Who the fuck is taking long-distance damage from Henry Cejudo barely connecting?
Henry Cejudo hits like a tank.
Nobody in 135 not named John Dodson hits like a tank.
He shuts lights off.
Does he?
Ask TJ Dillashaw.
Oh, you mean Tilly Dilly? Nobody cares.
Old dopey TJ.
You mean the guy that got knocked out by Dominic Cruz? That guy?
Yeah.
Little old paper chin?
mostly on Cruz. You put yourself in a really bad position. You were losing the fight, too. It's kind of like saying don't leave in the hands of the judges.
It's not like he put himself in the position. I mean, Cejudo, that knee to the face was masterful, and that was great.
Yeah, and Dom, I don't know. He can't assume that he's going to win the fight anyways. But and he really crossed the line after the fight when he said Keith Peterson smelled like cigarettes and alcohol.
I mean, here's the thing. That is a normally solid ref who fucked up in both times I really was paying attention to him. Maybe he was.
If Keith Peterson smelled at all like any kind of alcohol or drugs, Dominic Cruz has been around the game a long enough time, he's got enough status, he would have said something. He would have said something to his corners, he would have said something to an inspector.
He did, after the fight.
Yeah, after he had to make up excuses.
Dude.
Cruz always
observing and reporting is not coming up with excuses, Chris.
Cruz has always been a crybaby, too.
He really has. It's hard to give him the benefit of the doubt, but he is a crybaby.
Now, let's talk about two real-ass men right here.
And maybe one of the best fights I've ever fucking seen.
Dude, that was... I mean, it's Ferguson's chin versus Gaethje's fist and which is going to break first.
Well, and the answer is both of them, because did you catch Justin popping his dislocated finger back into socket as Rogan interviewed him?
Yeah, yeah.
He looks down and he goes, oh, shit. And Joe's, like, still talking as he pops his finger back in joint. Like, the amount of pain that just that is, I was like, ugh.
Well, you already said it after that. Adrenaline! Adrenaline, baby! Yeah, yeah. Best drug in the world!
Oh, no, I could not be happier. You know me. I'm a huge Gaethje guy. And I pushed my fucking money on him. And I told everybody that he was going to beat Ferguson because I believed it, you know?
He clubs, man. And like we were talking earlier about, Khabib's got a problem on his hands now.
I think that low-key, Justin Gaethje is a worse matchup for Khabib than anybody else.
I think it is because Khabib's had the toughest time with Ally Quinta.
Yeah, and Michael Johnson cracked him too.
Yeah, but he had a tough time all five rounds with Ally Quinta.
Yeah, maybe, but here's the thing that I, like – Do you think he had the tough time with Ally Quinta, or do you think that, like, round four and five, he knew that he had it in the bag, so he wanted to stand up and bang because he knew the next guy he was fighting was Connor?
I'll have no way of knowing, but I do know that Gaethje's a better, way better version of Ally Quinta. It's like three times.
Well, and the other thing about Gaethje that people don't like know, I mean, I'm sure you obviously know it, but this dude's a wrestler. That was his pedigree. He grew up wrestling. So I'm not saying that he can stand with Khabib on the ground. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that when it comes to grappling, the people that have been training it their whole life, they have this insurmountable advantage that the people that haven't will never get. And Gaethje has that.
Remember Chuck Liddell when he first came out? Everybody was talking about how he's a banger. Then,
well, another great wrestler.
Yeah, they're like, oh, he can bang. Gaethje is a new Chuck.
Yeah, I think he's a new Robbie Lawler. But yeah, Chuck works too. I mean, Chuck is a better example of it. But the thing about Gaethje is, like, I mean, this fight. I mean, this is the best Gaethje ever. This guy was patient. Like, he just waited it out. He knew what he had to do. He sticks to the game plan, and they were talking about it all through the pay-per-view. It's that John Jones shit where when they're in the cage, they're just a mindless robot that will do what their corner tells them to.
Yep.
And that's, but, I think, you know, like, that's really important, is the how much are you going to do what your corner tells you to?
Yeah, yeah, and usually the guys who win are just robots, like you're saying. They are good robots, you know?
Yeah.
I
mean, one of the reasons John Jones is so good is in the game while they're, like, going, you've got Winkle John who's just – Jackson is sitting there making adjustments, and he's listening.
Yeah. How about I'm playing matchmaker here, but
– Oh, I already got the matches. Are you ready?
Well, I got Bryce Mitchell, you're Ryan Hall. Let's do it.
Yeah.
All right, who else you got?
Tony Ferguson, Dustin Poirier. Let's do that.
Yes.
They've never fought.
Yes.
And that just seems like the most logical thing. And then Gaethje, I know everybody thinks I'm nuts, but I still think Gaethje's going to fight McGregor before Khabib.
Gaethje said he won't fight anybody except for Khabib.
Right, but he also talked about in that post conference about how he's like, I mean, you know, I'm not going to say never because of the money. Like, that's him leaving it open.
Yeah. Yeah,
and here's the thing about the UFC. The UFC is going to want Gaethje McGregor because on paper, Gaethje is a better fight for McGregor. And so then they could have Khabib McGregor 2 and have fucking two belts on the poster, which we know fucking is the only way Daddy Dana gets hard these days.
What do you think they offered Gaethje for that McGregor fight to steer him towards McGregor? $2 million?
Maybe. I mean, I don't know. You know what's crazy to think about is he's making so – he has fucking 9 fights and he's had 7 bonus – or 7 fights and 9 bonuses.
Yeah, so he –
So, he might not even – you might be right. They might not even be able to bribe him with money. Plus, you know Khabib doesn't want to fight McGregor. Like, not because he doesn't think he could win, but because he hates him and he wants to fuck with him.
Yeah, and he wants to give the shot to Gaethje. And
right. Khabib. Plus, Gaethje and him have the same manager, so this was probably already on the table, talked about anyways.
Who does?
Gaethje's manager is the same manager as Khabib.
Oh, no shit, huh?
Yeah, Fassiz or whatever his name is.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, so I hope that happens. I really would like to see the sale of Connor-Khabib rematch with two belts. I'd like to see how Connor had what his answer for Gaethje would be, because Gaethje ain't getting knocked out either. That's the other tough part.
I mean, he can if you're precise, and, like, I mean, I don't know if you're McGregor, the precision striking. Well, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think Gaethje, like, I think we all watched Gaethje in World Series of Fighting, and we just thought that the level of competition was so much lower than the UFC that we didn't pay it much mind.
Yeah.
But now here we are. And his only real loss is Poirier. I mean, Poirier beat the fuck out of him, but guess what? Dustin Poirier's a world beater.
Yeah.
And then, like, the Eddie Alvarez fight, he had Alvarez dead to rights, and then he got overzealous. Eddie woke up and did some everyday Eddie shit like he does.
Yep.
And that's, like, there's no shame in that. And then everybody else, and this is the fucked up part. He's knocked out or stopped he stopped Tony Ferguson. It's not a decision. It's like he stopped him. And that was such a one-sided affair. It was crazy.
Yeah, it's tough because Gaethje, like, he seems to have learned so much. Apparently, one of his big problems was he was getting overzealous and just rushing in for finishes.
same problem Poirier had for a while there. And
I think that that's just a young blood thing, though, because I think when you're a guy on the rise, the moment you hit the majors, the moment you're in the UFC, that's the first time you catch these guys that you can't melt. You know, because like coming up like on the regional circuit, you know, it's like you said with I think it was like Anthony Smith. Like you see these guys on the local circuit and you can tell the guys that are going to rise to the top because they're just, they just have something above and beyond what other people have.
Yeah, and I think that they Gaethje's only problem is rushing in, and he's got that solved, man. He's going to be a really tough guy to beat now that he's a smart, wiser fighter. Yeah. In World Series of Fighting, he was just a lunkhead. I mean, he, not just a lunkhead, but he was a lunkhead.
The lunkhead. I mean, like, this guy has fucking, like, 30 and 40-second knockouts like they're nothing in a tournament where everybody was trying to win $1 million.
Yeah, and you watch him. He's just taking – remember him coming to the UFC and they're showing the highlight reel of him just getting worked over again and again and again? And then James Vick called him the Homer Simpson of MMA, and he said, shut up,
yeah,
James
but do
Vick,
you remember? Do you
career.
Remember when Gaethje hit him in his mouth and he looked like he was doing the wave straight down to the canvas?
Yeah.
That's one of my favorite highlights, not only because it's Gaethje, but because Vick is an idiot. Like, I've never seen any one person in MMA talk so much shit with so little to back it up in my life.
100% agree. But, yeah, I hope to see this. It's really going to mix up 155 well with this idea that Gaethje's in there and Gaethje's the title holder.
I think Gaethje has the ability to beat Khabib. And then
anybody.
Yeah, and then if you get – because the cool thing about Gaethje, and Gaethje was already kind of stoking the fire, is, like, this is totally America versus Russia. And, like, okay, you're saying that we have to roll in as a country against Russia, and we get to roll with Justin Gaethje into that. I don't mind that. It's like Poirier, when Poirier went over there. I don't – you know, these are – I don't mind this, you know? Like, fucking go get them,
please.
Guys.
Exactly. I get into some Rocky IV type of stuff for the next year or so.
I will kill him. I must crush him. Break him. Dude, that's what it is. I must break him.
And I know he's a controversial guy, but at the end of the day, still, it's weird seeing the president of the United States talking about MMA.
It is. It is weird, and it's cool. And I think, like, I don't know. I was talking to somebody else about this. I think that if you're a lifetime UFC fan, no matter what you think politically, you can't really hate Trump because he was there early and he was supporting the league.
Yeah, you know, I've been watching the I just started at one, and I'm trying to see how far I can go before life goes back to normal. And in the late 90s, early 2000s, there's about four or five, either in a row or really close to each other, at Trump Taj Mahal. During the dark days when nobody else was willing to give them a shot or hear them anywhere, he said, come to Trump Taj Mahal. And I know when they went there, they went from selling about 40 tickets to they go to Trump Taj Mahal and they have like a few, maybe
people. And that Taj Mahal, that was one of the first cornerstones of legitimizing it to get it get it regulated in every state.
And knowing the back workings of things, they gave away those tickets. Those were so many cop tickets.
Yeah. And what do they fucking care? They're making so much money off the casino, they don't give a fuck. At that point, everybody, like, I mean, at that point in time, like, what, you had four people that probably were requiring over league minimum pay? Maybe five. I mean, there weren't superstars. There were popular people. But, I mean, like, unless your name wasn't Liddell or fucking Silva, you weren't getting that money. I guess
Even then, the only guys back then – well, GSP wasn't even around yet at this point. Chuck Liddell was starting to make a name for himself. Tito was the only real big name. Tito and Pat Miletich were the two big names at this point.
Well, and that's why I never get mad at, like, Bellator, because people don't realize that a lot of these older fighters, I mean, they were fighting in parking lots for $200 a night.
Yeah.
You know, it's fight like they times. Like they are making – I mean, Conor McGregor made more in the WEC or Strikeforce or whatever league he was in coming up than, like, probably – fucking who back in the day, fucking, like, I don't know, Boss Rutten. He probably made more coming up into the majors than Boss Rutten made his entire career. Even as a commentator.
Even with his boss systems?
No, not including the boss systems. That was pure genius.
Well, anyways, I gotta go back to work.
All right, man. Hey, thanks. Thanks so much for joining us. Tell the people where to get a hold of you.
Find me at Sunday Fights. I don't know. Find me at Jiu-Jitsu After Dark on Instagram.
You motherfucker!
What? You want me to say Sunday Fight still?
Oh shit! Oh shit! All
right, get fucked. Get out of here. I hate you.
Right. Bye.
Bye. That was Chris talking a little MMMMMA. There we go. All right. We are settling in and getting ready. Perfect. All right. Who else do we want to fucking talk to? I mean, talk to whoever the fuck we want, man. I think the move is over here. 1 second.
Hello.
What up, dog?
Not much. How you doing?
Good. Yourself?
Oh, I'm doing all right.
Tell the people who you are.
This is Tom Chilstrom at Tom Chilstrom at Twitter and Instagram, Tom, or Facebook.com/Tom.Chilstrom.
Yeah, I can tell.
The regular.
I can tell you got the little aggression to your voice. You okay, buddy?
I'm doing okay, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, just another Sunday, another day in this fucking hell we call quarantine.
It's becoming hell for you now?
Well, I don't know. Like, I mean, I can still go out. I still obviously have work tomorrow and shit like that. I'll see some people, but I don't know, man. Like, it's just getting fucking boring as fuck.
Yeah, it feels like it's wrenched on your soul in a way that it didn't before.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I mean, obviously because of what we do outside of talking to each other on this Twitch show, you know, without doing comedy and stuff like that, man, like, I am fucking losing my goddamn mind. Like, even just having the opportunity just to go to a mic and just kind of fuck around and say some stupid shit and maybe get a fucking stupid pity laugh.
I have a laugh track. Tell a joke, man.
Tell a joke?
Yeah, just tell something you've written. What would you say if you were on stage right now?
Alright. I don't know if you guys have ever been on a road trip down 35, but I will tell you guys this, that if you go through Iowa, Kansas, and Oklahoma, they're all having a competition about who can have the most Christian and country music stations. I don't know who the fuck is winning that, but I know who the fuck is losing their goddamn mind, and it's this fucking guy with the broken goddamn radio. So, I mean, I haven't taken a trip down to Texas in a while or whatever, but, you know, just get on the road, baby. I gotta fucking do something. I'm losing my fucking mind.
And that's not your best work, man. I'm not gonna lie.
I know, man. It's literally something I just thought of.
I was gonna say, man. I'm concerned about your mental well-being.
Oh, now you're concerned about my mental well-being. That's
just
good.
Just now, actually, it just happened.
Just now.
Mm-hmm.
Right. No, I don't know, man. You lose motivation when you're just sitting inside and you can't even fucking go and dick around at a mic or anything, or you're just fucking around and just talking shit to people in person, you know.
Well, I'll tell you this. I care for you, and that's why we're going to have this conversation and not read the comments going on in the chat room.
They all call me.
Don't
oh.
Look. Don't look. Don't look. Head up.
I saw one.
No. Which one did you see?
Korean girl bites lower lip. Oh, Tom, broken radio jokes.
Yep. The one below that says, Tom is not funny. Just be side effects of crack.
Oh, freaky deaky? Okay. No, I mean, I shouldn't have read the comments. You're right.
Oh, here you go. Prop me beside the jukebox says, Tom cracks me up. Get it?
Oh, that's fun.
See what they did
that's
there?
Good. I did see what they did there. But I don't know, man. It's just one of those days, man. Just one of those fucking days.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't do shit.
So what is one of those days? Because I rarely, like, I don't know, man. Like, you're not a very uplifting person anyways, but, like, you just, today was, like, down for you, it seemed. Like, are you just, or, like, what happened? Take us through your day, man. What happened?
I don't.
It started out awesome this morning because we did a really good post show. That was fun.
Yeah, that was fun.
And then you woke up, man. Still Tom Chilstrom. I mean, I could see how that would wear on you.
Yeah, that's helpful.
I'm not helping.
Well, I mean, no one's ever really called you helpful in the past, so I shouldn't, I guess, at this point. So.
Is that another,
I don't know, man.
Is that another radio joke?
No, it's just you being Corey. Corey doing Corey. Corey being Corey, all that sort of shit.
Corey being Corey.
Yeah, you got your own little moniker now.
Okay.
I mean,
it's not as good as Crackhead Tom or calling Joey Coco Goat.
Yeah, that was pretty good. I mean, I've been drinking a little bit today, so that's probably not helpful with the mental health today, but fuck it, I need to do something. I didn't even drink that much yesterday, which is weird because that was a long pay-per-view with all those fucking decisions and shit, so.
Oh, Korean girl really bites that. Lower lip is Morgan.
Oh, nice. Very cool. Hi, Morgan. It's good to have you
Morgan
here.
Morgan says, that is a word of euphemism for Christians have small dicks. He's talking about your radio joke, I think.
Yeah, that's about right.
Texas Theft says, because crack. Ran Out of Thought says, Tom rocks crack. At least it's not snowing again. Yeah, that's fair. Yeah, is that what it is? Maybe it's like a barometer pressure thing.
That's true. I mean, I don't know if you follow any of the weather apps, but they actually do have different testing and stuff like that. There's one that I saw that actually will help you decide or determine whether it's going to be a good day for a migraine or not, basically.
Do you have a migraine?
No, not today, but...
Wait, you don't have a migraine today?
No, I don't.
Okay, and you're in the chat room?
Yeah.
Okay, hang up, watch this video, and then I'm calling you back.
Okay.
Then we're going to get a reaction video. We're giving you homework because I know when I'm depressed, menial tasks cheer me up.
Right. Gotcha.
All right. Hang up and watch this link and get ready to explain it because it's crazy.
Okay.
All right. Goodbye.
Bye.
That is Tom Chilstrom. We're going to go over to this link. I forgot all about this today. Let's see. We're going to do this. And that. And that. That. We're getting there, guys. Slowly but surely. I wonder if this will get me a violation. This is one of the craziest things I've seen in fucking forever. And if you know me, that's saying a lot. So this is fucking crazy. Check this shit out.
My face is the front of shop. My face is the real shop front. My shop is the face I front. I'm real when I shop my face.
Thank you.
this is the real shop front. My shop is the fix I front, front. I'm real when I shop my face.
Yeah, so that happened. That's like a bad fucking dream right there for sure. Yeah, that is definitely tough to watch, right? Nothing we can do about that here. Yep. Hold on. We gotta bring back the Tom because we're going to talk to him about that because this was nightmare material, specifically for Tom and his really good mood today. Sounds like things are just not going well for Tommy boy. That's okay. We still love him. I just want to hear what he thinks of this because this shit was crazy. Are you still alive?
Yeah, of course I'm still alive, but what the fuck
right.
was that?
I don't know. It's fucking crazy, right?
It was, but I mean, where the fuck did you find that?
This place called the Internet.
No shit, Sherlock, but why the fuck did you find it?
Whoa, calm the aggro. Why did this rubbed you wrong? Were you marketed out as a small child? Does this resonate or something?
No, I just don't understand the point of why I gotta give a fucking commentary on this weird piece of shit.
Why is it a weird piece of shit? It's someone's art, Tom.
Really?
Yeah, somebody clearly spent a lot of time on that.
Well, I understand that, but also, too, when you go to, like, the Walker Art Center, like, that's the kind of shit you see, and you're just like, why the fuck did anybody think this was art?
You don't think that was art?
I mean, don't get me wrong, it's not for me to say because I'm not an art critic, but
he said critiquing art.
I wouldn't have fucking paid for it, to be honest.
I wouldn't have fucking paid for it.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody asked for a grant for that shit, I would be like, dude, give me my motherfucking money back. Are you shitting me? But I will say this, though, too. It always, like, that kind of weird fucking house beat kind of shit always reminds me of a. That KMFDM.
Yeah.
Was it God, what is their fucking song? That Drug on War or War on Drugs or
War on Drugs.
Yeah. Something like that.
Apology accepted.
But
so do you think this helped? Do you think that video helped your mood?
No.
No.
It honestly a drug against war, that's what it is.
Drugs against KMFDM, war. KMFDM. Yeah.
A drug against war, yeah. No, it didn't help my fucking mood. It made me more pissed off.
Really?
Yes.
Why did that tap into something that made you more pissed off?
I don't know. Fucking, it just seemed like it was, like, if you were being tortured, yep, that would be something that somebody would torture you with. Just
see, I would think it'd be your stand-up.
You think that's my stand-up?
That would be what they would torture me with. Everybody's hell is different, right?
You know, that really hurt, Corey.
You know what? Given that pause, I feel like it did actually really hurt you. And of course, Tom, I am joking.
You're joking, but that fucking hurt, man.
No, it didn't. I don't like what post video Tom is all about.
Post video Tom is the same as the fucking before video Tom.
He's way more sensitive.
No, I'm just more pissed off.
Pre-video Tom wouldn't have got hurt by a jab from a friend.
Yes, he would have.
No.
I mean, I don't consider any of these people in the comments my friends, and they're all calling me crackheads. I don't get fucking disturbed by that, man. You're a friend of mine, goddammit. Why you gotta do that to me? Why you gotta be like that?
What did I do?
Don't act so fucking innocent. What do I do? What do I do? You showed me that? You showed all of us that fucking video. You should be ashamed of yourself.
I feel like in the list of things I should be ashamed of myself for, that video doesn't even crack the list.
I understand that. But you're not normal. And some of the people in the comments are somewhat normal. And you didn't give them any fucking warning beforehand about what the fuck this was.
What do you mean?
Fuck you, freaky deaky, you piece of shit. It's, you are a whining bitch, Tom. Not your. I don't own a whining bitch, you fucking moron. Fucking people. Why am I so fucking pissed off,
Tom,
all the time?
Tom. What? I think this is your moment to go off against the crowd. Get them. This is every day that these motherfuckers have been picking on you. You get to direct it at them. Get them, dude. Go.
No, because Taxes Theft is pissed off that I'm getting way too serious. I'm sorry, Taxes Theft 80. The video was fun. Okay, maybe you're wrong. Yeah, I saw that. I'm seeing all these comments. I'm seeing Does Tom need a hug? Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Fucking, I need something. Meds? Maybe. I don't know. I should stop reading the comments, though. That's your job. Yeah, I know. Clearly. Him or Taxes Theft. Neither one. Come at me, pussy. Let's hear you cry some more. Oh, Jesus. No, I mean, they're right, though. I am just bitching for the sake of fucking bitching and crying over fucking nothing, I guess. Who said that? Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Kittens or puppies video. I don't know, man. It just, I'm all fucked up in the head. I got too many fucking things I'm thinking about, and it always seems to happen on a fucking Sunday. That's probably why. Yeah, probably. So. Oh, God, that's such a lovely idea.
Oh, yeah, I was muted the whole time. I hit the mute button. You could hear me, but they couldn't.
Oh, well, now I just sound like an asshole.
No, it sounds great.
Yeah, I'm losing my mind on the fucking, on the show. It's great.
Listen to Tom. Talk to nobody live.
Oh, that's good. That's great.
Wrinkly Balls on Your Mom says, I think Tom needs to take a rope and a chair to his garage and use the chair to tie the rope to the rafters and then the other end around his neck and step off the chair.
Oh, well, I can't do that because I've already promised Corey that I will never commit suicide. So
Yeah, and you're a man of your word. No matter how hard that gets, deal with it. Prop Me Up Beside the Jukebox says, sounds like Tom is talking to himself.
I mean, I do that. Muted. Yeah, I do that. Yeah.
So what about today made it more dark than normal? Because I know you have waves where, like, you'll have good days and you'll have bad days and shit, but, like, is it just, like, Sunday hits and you're like, fuck this?
Well, I mean, not always, but a lot of times it's fuck this. But, I don't know, being the quote-unquote special occasion today might fuck me up a little bit more. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, duh. How many of these have you had without your mom?
This is number two.
Okay, yeah.
Three.
Check it out.
Three.
Check it out. You get four before I'll make fun of you for it.
Oh, that's fair.
Yeah. You know what, number three? No big deal. Push, dude. No wonder you don't feel good. Your mother died and it's Mother's Day. That would suck.
Yeah, I mean, it can. But
on the bright side, at least you don't have to, like, travel across town to hang out with. I mean, obviously you would love to do that. I'm not saying you wouldn't, but it's like, that is kind of a pain in the ass to, like, drive across town to go hang out with your family, you know?
Yeah, a little bit, but I mean, it's not like anybody else is out on the town. I mean, I drove to the grocery store today at 9 o'clock and there was no one there, which is weird for a Sunday that there's no one out at the stores or whatever, whether it be Mother's Day or any other
Tom
day.
Tom Chilstrom thought his social life couldn't get worse comes coronavirus. Like, man, it really feels like people are avoiding me out here. Like, I love thinking of the idea of, like, somebody that was in a coma for 2 months just waking up right now.
Oh, you like that idea?
I just think it's funny, yeah.
I would hate to be the person that had to explain the last 2 months of their life and, like, why all of a sudden, like, hey, you know what? You actually can't leave the hospital right now because the one test we didn't do to you while you were in a coma was whether or not you have coronavirus. And, yes, the coronavirus is that thing that you heard from China and all that sort of shit before you got in this coma. But you can't leave until you take this big, giant swab up your fucking nose, almost touching your brain, actually.
Have you had that swab?
Huh?
Have you had it?
No, I haven't, but I've seen videos of people getting that test, and it's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah? Are you going to get it? Are you going to get tested?
I don't need to get tested, no.
No, I'm talking for corona, not STD. Clearly, you don't need STD screenings. You have to have sex. That's
a good point, Corey. Thank you for that. Thank you for bringing up that sad tale as well. Do you want to keep going? You want to go on about my depression?
Yeah. What do you want me to know about your depression, Tom?
I mean, not a whole lot. I mean,
okay.
I mean, I know you have a tendency to use things as or weaponize things against people. So
I don't think that's the term I'd use. I make observations for my own benefit.
Right.
Also, you sound like you're looking fat today.
Looking, feeling, acting, sure, that's about right. Yeah. I'm fat, you fucking idiot. I mean, good God, what do you want me to say? I mean,
Taxes Steph says he takes meds for depression, Tom. Yeah, maybe. Have you ever thought about getting some meds?
No.
No?
Well, I mean, I've thought about it, yeah, but I haven't done it yet.
You probably should stop self-medicating with booze, too. But I'm not the guy to throw that stone.
Apparently you are, though. You're the one who fucking brought it up, goddammit. And you're probably right.
Yes. Who did?
You just brought it up now that I shouldn't self-medicate with booze.
When did that happen?
Right now.
No way.
Just now.
Bullshit. Just now. Fake news.
You are fake
crack.
News.
Fuck you, Tovar. Fucking dick.
You know what's funny about Tovar is you know he's just in his living room laughing that little weird hyena laugh of his. The like,
yeah,
you know, the big like wheezy one where he's like, I'm missing the pitch, but that's how he real gut laughing.
Yeah, but I miss it. I miss hearing that in person. So, you know, like we all do because we miss hearing laughter.
Everybody agrees that less crack is probably where you should start to cure yourself, you know?
Yeah, I know. That's going to be... I'm going to start doing less crack tomorrow, everybody. How about that? Yeah, my word, everybody. I'm going to start doing less crack on Monday, okay?
Okay.
I'm going to finally get in on that New Year's resolution that I never had.
Tovar says, my laughter is my depression.
That doesn't make sense.
Get him. Get him, Tom.
No, I'm just saying it doesn't make sense. His laughter is... My laughter is my depression. That doesn't make sense.
No, he was saying that his laughter is his depression. Like, you know how we were talking, making fun of his laugh?
I wasn't making fun of his laugh. You were making fun of his laugh.
Okay, Tom. I said, remember when I was making fun of his laugh that you just referenced? That's what he's talking about. He's saying his laughter is his depression.
All right. I mean, yes. I shouldn't be drinking today. While feeling like a rundown fucking piece of shit. But I didn't do any crack today either, so. Or ever. If we're ever gonna fucking try and give this fucking bit up.
We got a new follower, Shingle Box is here.
Who's a follower?
I don't know. The name is Shingle Box.
All right. Is that James Wells? Roofing reference there? No? Anybody?
I refuse to believe James Wells knows how to operate a computer.
I saw an Instagram profile that looked like his, but it could easily be a fake of somebody who just used his profile picture from Facebook and just put it on Instagram, and that's
yeah,
it.
I mean, we're getting really close to him being a vulnerable adult.
You know, that's what tar fumes will do to you, though. I mean, when you literally have just huffed yourself into retardation, I mean, what are you going to do, right?
Shinglebox says nope. Tovar says James is a hot tar roofer, no shingles.
And you know what shingles are made of, Tovar? Fucking tar.
Taxes Theft says, can we make Tom cry or just lose it?
I almost fucking cried already, okay? So I fucking held it back.
What makes you cry?
Fucking don't. I'm not going to go down that fucking weird hole with you or this fucking audience, okay?
When will you be comfortable enough to let us in?
Listen, you are my friend. Tor is my friend. I'm sure there's a couple other people on this chat that are actually friends of mine and stuff like that, but I'm not going to fucking share this stuff with an audience on Twitch that will then eventually go over to YouTube and talk about it on this medium, if you will.
Because you have to keep up appearances on YouTube?
No, I just need to fucking not be a goddamn vulnerable person all the fucking goddamn time, and I'm trying to hold some shit in. How about that?
You can do that. Nobody's asking you to not hold it. I'm just asking questions, man.
I understand that. I know you have your show to run.
Freaky Deaky says, I'm your friend, Tom.
I don't see, again, people hide behind nicknames on fucking the internet. I don't know who fucking Freaky Deaky is.
Texas Theft says, you're a great guy, and you need to realize that.
All right. If people start giving me fucking comments, I'm going to probably fucking lose it.
Prop me up beside the jukebox says, Tom, it's okay to cry. It's therapeutic.
Shut the fuck up. I don't need your psycho babble bullshit. Prop me up against the jukebox or beside the jukebox. I don't fucking need it.
Magic Garzmo says, he let me call him Japanese Tom Arnold.
I didn't let you do that. You probably just did it. I'm not going to fucking argue. Everybody has their fucking opinions on what I look like or who I am. I don't give a fuck. I do give a fuck, but I'm trying to fucking act tough and brave right now, and it's
You're doing good, except for the commentary in between.
I know. That's what I'm...
Taxes Theft really says, it's okay. Hi, Tom. I'm Brady. Now you know. Now we aren't strangers anymore. It kind of sounds like he's trying to lure you in a van, man. I would stay away from him. That's real creepy.
It's not, well, it is kind of creepy when you say van, but I don't know, Brady.
Ran out of thought says, just remember, you've always got Margaret.
I will fucking find you, ran out of thoughts, and I will slit your goddamn throat.
No, Tom, do you think that aggressive nature is helping you make friends?
No, clearly it's not helping me make friends. Also, too, totally joking over here. I'm not losing my mind at all.
He seems like he has it all together to me.
Take another sip of whiskey. Yay, there we go. Okay.
What are you drinking?
Buffalo Trace bourbon.
How is it?
It's not bad. I've had better bourbons and some of that, but yeah, it's not bad. It's just...
Tovar says, Tom, if you lose 50 pounds, I'll let you cry on a jet ski.
Wait, hold on. Doesn't Tovar normally go jet skiing with Brian McCormick?
Yeah.
What is Brian weighing these days?
Like three of you, probably.
No, I mean, I know he's been losing weight. He's on, like, keto or whatever.
Has he? He did not look like he was losing weight the last time I saw him.
The last time I saw him was, like, I think a year ago now. Okay, never mind. Yeah, thanks, Tovar.
Yeah, Tovar says he can't ride them either. Seriously, I think he knows what he's doing, and it's very balanced. See, Brady's got your back, man.
Thanks, Brady.
See, you made a friend. You were a little bit vulnerable, and you made a friend today, Tom.
Thanks. Brady, it's good to have friends.
Prop me up beside the jukebox, says Tom. You can always cry on my jet ski.
No, apparently I can't. Apparently I have way too much for jet skis.
Renathon says he has given up dreams of riding jet skis.
I never really had a dream of riding a jet ski. I just figured eventually maybe I would do it. I don't know. Some of those things you just dream about, right?
CrackBabies89 says, it's okay, Tom. It's not your fault that I am the way I am.
Yeah, I know it's not my fault that you are the way you are. Who the fuck are these people?
They're your friends, Tom. Sometimes when you stare out into the abyss, Twitch looks back and says, hi, Tom, cry.
What?
Do you want to watch the video again? Is that what this is about?
I do not want to watch that video ever again in my life.
Do you think you will have nightmares?
No, because I've gone to the Walker Art Center and I've seen some of the weird shit that people think is artistic there. So,
what's the weirdest thing you've ever seen that people said was artistic?
There is one of those like weird what is it, postmodern or some shit like that, where like somebody had a video at the Walker. And it's, like, of just an eye. And then, like, then it switches over to, like, a fly on the wall, switches over to a hand, switches over to a chicken being fucking beheaded.
Deheaded?
And beheaded, yeah. I don't know, like, it's not disturbing, but it's just weird. Like, again, that somebody can get to consider that art. You know what I'm going to do? I'm actually just going to find a blank piece of paper. I'm going to just draw a little fucking doodle on it, put it in a fucking frame, and then I'm going to try and sell that as art. What do you think?
Do it. I mean, that's, just call it, like, Lotsy.
See? Yeah, or just make up a name for a nickname for myself, you know, like Banksy has his thing.
One of the stupidest things I've ever seen when it came to art like that is I went to the MIA or whatever?
Right.
MAI?
Yeah, well, the Minneapolis Institute of Art is actually generally pretty good.
Yeah,
but
I went there, right? And there was a conceptual thing there where it was a art installment coming, and it was like basically supposed to just look like a half setup thing, but it just looked like I should walk away and go look at other stuff.
Yeah, you probably should. I mean, actually, my brother likes the MIA a lot more than some of the other ones in town. So, and he is
Freaky Deaky says, write a diary, Tom. That way, when you read it later on in life, you can remember being how whiny and bitchy you were.
I don't need to write a journal to see how bitchy I am. I have these fucking videos now, goddammit, okay? I can go back and watch Corey's channel anytime, which is, youtube.com/Corey Adam Comedy.
More importantly, if they subscribe, they can watch all the archives right here on Twitch. Also, go to Venmo at Corey Adam Comedy. Donate big, donate hard. Also, CoreyAdamComedy@gmail.com on PayPal. I'm getting pretty good at that.
You are getting pretty good at that.
It's always nice to get good at pandering, I guess. Maybe if I had hung out with Daryl Horner a little longer, he would have taught me how to properly pander.
That wasn't pandering, that was selling. You should know the difference.
He did say that, that's true.
Yeah, because pandering would be if you had a live audience right in front of you and you're trying to get them to like you based off of what you say. You're just trying to sell your goods to them, which they're already here, but you're just trying to expand your profile to then say other places. So, again, yes, it is youtube.com/ Corey Adam Comedy, all one word, no dots or anything like that in between. If you're looking for all these videos on his playlist.
Have you gone back and watched any of them?
No, because I hate you.
Yeah, me too. same reason.
Right. Oh, you already have the...
Tovar says, Daryl is definitely getting more free Chipotle than you are, Corey, you amateur.
Well, yeah, I mean, maybe. I mean, Daryl also probably just knows somebody he can suck dick of to get free Chipotle, but... By the way, everybody, if you were trying to listen last night, we did the show late. So the UFC 249 ran until about midnight, and then we did the post-fight. So that's over on Corey's YouTube channel as well. Or you can, again, go to the archives here on Twitch, and you can find it. See? It's selling you, baby.
It's pretty good. Prop me up beside the jukebox, says Tom. How much have you donated to Corey?
Time-wise or money-wise? Because if I'm on this show every fucking night, I mean, that's a lot of time. I think even yesterday, that show yesterday was almost 2 hours long. I think it was on for like an hour and 40 minutes or something.
Yeah, I don't know.
So
we were just both excited about the fights.
It was a damn good pay-per-view, I'll be honest with you. That's probably the thing. I mean, I had nothing to live for today. I mean, yeah, Money in the Bank was happening tonight, but WWE can suck my dick. So...
Yeah, maybe that's why you're so depressed, because the WWE product is so weak.
Mm-hmm. Like, honestly, Money in the Bank should be way more fucking exciting, but, you know, especially this year, they're having them go from the ground floor to the top of the WWE headquarters to then climb up a ladder to get a briefcase. And they booked Nia Jax in the women's match thinking that she's somehow going to make it up fucking stairs. Like 12 flights of stairs to get to the fucking roof of that building. Are you shitting me?
That does seem absolutely preposterous.
Yeah, she literally just had two knee surgeries and was out almost a year. So why would you think that somehow she's going to be booked as strong for this fucking match?
Yeah, there's no fucking way. You are absolutely correct. There's no fucking way that happens at all. It's like, I don't know. Yeah, and that's always hard as a fan, too, because you're like, why would you even book this? Fuck you guys.
Right. I mean, the best decision they had was when they had, I'm using air quotes here, Apollo Crews go down with an injury to then book AJ Styles into that match, because then at least you have two viable options to then be threats for a title with Daniel Bryan and AJ Styles. And again, I'm not even fucking watching that show, but I just know... That's what's going on and stuff, so.
Yeah, I mean, that's... Yeah, you're not wrong there.
Right. See? Brought it back to sports entertainment in some way or another.
You did. You did a good job, man. I mean, I'm telling you, dude. You got this.
Let me try this joke now for size on, too. Let's just run that route.
Oh, look at this. Now you're running even more material. Proud of you, man. Good for you.
I'm going to do something. So,
good for you. Do you want to watch that movie again?
What movie?
That video? Yeah.
No.
Okay.
No one wants to watch that video, Corey.
Come on. Well, that's actually kind of the cool part about having your own show. I just put it on there.
I get that.
All right, let's hear your next joke, Tom.
All right. Now, some people might be offended, but I also at this point don't give a shit. So
Wait. You don't give a shit?
Well, I mean, at this point, if you can't tell that Corey and I both tell jokes at some level or another, then you're foolish, and then whatever words we say should be taken with a grain of salt. So there's that. That's all I'm going to say, I guess. But the joke goes, most people would be shocked to know that I am a professional wrestling fan, and that's probably because I can bathe myself properly, and I'm not mildly autistic. See? It's kind of offensive. So I don't tell it on stage.
Now, is the joke there that you're more than mildly autistic?
Yes. That's. I mean, you can apply that however you want. I mean, I'm not autistic, but, I mean, if you want to go that route, Corey, go ahead.
No, I was asking for clarification on your joke.
You don't ask clarification dork. For a joke. You know that.
What a dork. What a
dork. Are you trying to heckle me now?
Apology accepted.
Yeah. Is it working? Do you feel heckled?
I mean, I don't know really where you want me to go. I mean, do you want me to go appearance-wise on you, like what you sound like?
Oh, yeah, let's do this. This will be fun. I'm actually here, and I'll even put the camera on me so they can see the heart reaction of my voice. Go ahead. Give it to me. Give it to me good.
I see I put too much pressure on myself now, too. I'm fucking blanking on what to call you or say to you.
Man, these are some good roast burns, Tom.
Shut the fuck up.
Wow.
I mean, have you ever actually heard your tone of voice? Have you actually heard yourself in your recordings or anything? Or do you just assume, like, how you sound in your head is how you sound to everybody else?
It's a trick question. I don't care.
Oh, that can't be true. Because I've heard your material, and I know for a fact that you fucking care.
Nah.
I know you pretend like you don't because it's better for your...
It's not pretending, man. It's what it is.
Right. I know it works better with your quote-unquote persona to act like you don't care, but...
Oh. Are you still... It's still going on? Okay, go ahead.
No.
What are you saying I sound like? What are you going after? Go.
I mean... You sound like a Midwestern version of Carl from Aqua Teen Hunger Force. And then, of course, you also look like Carl from Aqua Teen Hunger Force. So what I'm saying
really,
is...
You can't really insult somebody with what they have cosplayed before.
That is true. You have done that, haven't you?
Yeah. Hmm. All you're really doing by telling me I look like Carl is telling me I'm very good at my cosplay. You're actually appreciating me within your hate. Take it in. My majesty is for your eyes alone.
Yeah, you're right.
Here's a new name for you. Corey Adams Rogue Thumb. That's pretty funny. Because I cut off my thumb?
Yeah, I got it.
Oh. You don't find that funny?
Not really.
Why not, Tom?
I don't know. Who's carrying that profile?
I don't know.
Oh, they find it funny, though. That's good. Good for you, Corey Adams, Rogue Thumb. Jesus.
Yeah, you thought I was making that up, huh?
No, I see it on there.
And they spaced it out, so we know. But it's like, I don't know. I mean, I guess it's technically an S there, but my name's Adam. There should be no S.
Well, they can't add... Yeah, I don't think you can add apostrophes into their names.
Well, it's phonetically incorrect. It's bothering me.
Is that what's bothering you?
No, actually. Nothing bothers me. I'm beyond earthly emotions.
All right, freaky deaky. I'll work on my funniness. How about that?
Don't take that to heart, Tom. Tom, we talked about this. You're reading the comments now.
I am reading the comments because I don't
do it. Now they're all going to start telling you to cry. Watch.
No, I just.
I'm just saying, man, you got to ignore them. They're like animals at the zoo. If you don't make eye contact, they'll just fucking roll around acting like you're not there.
You know, actually, speaking of zoos, there's a wildlife.
Man, I thought you said speaking of Zeus.
No, speaking of zoos.
Hey, guys, speaking of Zeus, our all-omnipotent lightning god. All right, go ahead, Zeus, go.
Yeah, there's a like a wildlife center up in Ham Lake area. So north of the cities, north of Blaine even. But when I was working at the maintenance job, the operations department went over to this and did their little volunteer thing for that quarter, mm-hmm. and they had a mountain lion cage or cougar cage there.
And I had to clean up. Courtney Cox in it?
No.
No.
Good one though. But I had to clean up around it, and you know, you only have basically this chain link fence between you and this animal. And the whole time this thing is trying to stalk me like it's going to pounce on me. So I just kept turning around and just staring at it. And this cat got meaner and meaner and more aggressive because it was just so pissed off that I was willing to fucking just stare this thing down. But pretty fun, actually, I'll be honest with you. Just stare at a big cat like that in the eyes and yep. wait for it to fucking try and do something when it can't. Oh, God. All the power is on my end, man. Never felt more alive in my life.
That's good. No, Drew, we're not running an hour behind. The scope of everything is beyond you, my friend. You were going to be on earlier. Tom seemed like he needed to, like, bleed out loud, so we're here doing that. Next time you want to act like you're important, don't move to North Dakota. Pro move. Matt Doima says Tiger King Season 2. Is that happening? Is it going on?
No, I think he was saying for what I just talked about.
Oh. I thought sometimes he just pops in and he just says shit. So I didn't know if he, I guess he was there. He also cosplayed Carl, apparently.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I bet mine was better. And I bet he wasn't even doing any character. He wasn't even doing the voice. Fuck you, Mr. Meat Monster.
It's not a really great Carl, actually.
I know. I have to hear him. Once I hear, you know what? I'm going to play him.
You know, actually, you know what? I will say this. You have beadier eyes than Matt Doima, so you definitely look more like Carl. All
right, fuck you, first of all.
That's, sure, whatever. I'm fucking just being honest.
Hold on, here we go.
It's not even a fucking roast joke. That's literally just being honest.
Is that all you came to say?
Is that all you came to say, or, yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's because I was making fun of Joey. It's just Coca-Zella time. I can't do it anymore.
I know.
I've lost it.
Yeah, life's so difficult, isn't it?
It is kind of difficult. You're not wrong. But you know what? That's okay, Tom. That's how we get through life. The difficulties remind us of the good parts.
You have more John Stossel stuff coming up?
No, I was looking at that earlier, but it didn't happen. Yeah, I don't think he's put out anything in a while. Trying to help him get out there, but you know, he just all right, let's go back to these assholes in the chat room, shall we? Carry out, bro. Don't cry because you're getting picked on. Just cry so we can laugh it off for once. Corey's Rogue Thumb really wants you to cry, Tom.
I'm not gonna cry.
I know, I don't think so either. It's okay to cry. It actually releases tension chemicals.
Who is a comment?
That's Taxes Theft. Yeah, it says cry because you need to.
Okay.
Drew says, I love Tom. I don't mind listening. I just support crackheads.
Great. Thanks, Drew.
Crack Baby says, don't call us assholes. I swear I'm not crying. What happened to Corey's thumb? I cut it off in junior high.
Yeah, I mean, how are you on this Twitch show and you haven't heard his bit about the bandsaw?
Not everyone's a fan, Tom. Some of them are enemies. Yeah, my thumb left me.
Well, I mean, listen, Corey, as much as I don't like you sometimes, I've at least heard all your bits. And most of them are okay. Especially the ones you record and put on albums.
You know, Tom, I know how downtrodden you are today, so I'm going to take that malicious compliment as it was intended. Thank you, buddy.
It was a compliment.
I know it was, but you're mad, so you got like those gruff overtones to your compliments.
You're right. My tone needs to change a little bit.
I didn't say it needs to change. Keep doing you.
Who's doing me doesn't sound very good, especially with the fucking weird shit I've been going through. So.
Well, don't, like, do you as in kill yourself. Like, maybe masturbate a little bit. Release some tension or something. Cry.
I'm not going to. I might masturbate. That might work, but.
Check it out. Release double the tension. Cry while you're masturbating.
No, because then I feel like I'm going to fucking cause a goddamn weird fetish shit to happen. And I'm going to be fucked for life, because every time I fucking have sex, I'm going to start crying. That's going to be weird for everybody.
Whatever, the hookers will just take the money and go. They don't care what you do.
Listen, hookers are classy individuals. I don't want you talking shit about them, okay, Corey?
Wow, that's a man who's fucked some hookers.
It's the world's oldest profession. You show those broads some
respect. It's the world's oldest profession.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. You sure know a lot of hooker history, Tom.
Everybody's referred to prostitution as the world's oldest profession.
Can you please make a podcast called Hardcore Hooker History?
I mean, I don't know that much about hooker history. I mean, what is it?
On
like,
this episode of Hardcore Hooker History, Charlamagne gets A-framed.
Oh, Charlamagne, huh? That's... I don't know if... Didn't he have a concubine? He probably didn't need... hookers. I mean, most of those old-timey rulers had just, you know, a harem of women, so they wouldn't necessarily need prostitutes.
Tonight on Hardcore Hooker History, what happens when Mary Magdalene takes a whole mandolin?
I mean,
in her pussy!
I mean, if I was going to do a prostitution podcast, why would I just start with Jack the Ripper targeting prostitutes in Whitechapel?
Because you never lead off with your best episode, Tom. That's basic marketing.
What if that's not the best episode? What if I got other things? You know, like
and
a
I
full.
Both know that'll be the best episode.
No, man, the best episode would be a full review of Pretty Woman. We all know that. Come on.
Because you look like Roy Orbison.
No, because of the Julia Roberts.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, see, Jesus. That was probably the best joke I was going to fucking lay out all night.
I agree. I laid on that one.
God damn it, you were dumb.
That hurts. I deserve that.
No, you don't. I shouldn't have said it.
Jesus Christ, dude. Heel or baby face? Pick one.
I can't be mean to the actual friends right now.
Why?
Because.
Tell me you wish I was dead.
No, I don't
Come
wish
on.
You were dead.
You could wish I was dead. I could get off this show. I could go kill myself, and you would never be okay ever again. That's how you affect people. That's how you leave a legacy, Tom.
Listen, I know you're going to die before I do, but Lord knows if you fucking die because of suicide or whatever, that I will not be okay. So don't you do that. If I ever fucking made a promise to you, that I'm not going to fucking kill myself.
Dude, my suicide note is literally going to say, please describe how I died in intimate detail to Tom Chilstrom.
I know your suicide note is going to start with that. I know it.
Yeah.
God, you're such an ass.
P.S. Don't bury me next to Tom. He could never follow me.
Oh, I could follow you, motherfucker. I don't think so, bro.
That dirt is hot. That's a hot room.
I don't know, man. I mean, I know for a fact I could open for you. I don't know. I mean, maybe I couldn't follow you, but I sure as hell would give it a fucking go.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just joking. I'm talking about dying.
Yeah, I know.
You wish me dead, and now I have no resort but to do something drastic to make you feel terrible.
Did not wish you death. I just said I know you for a fact you're going to die before.
Check it out. You know how we were spotting you three Mother's Days? After I kill myself tonight, you get three more. So, like, you know, don't even worry about it, man. You got three more to just be a dick. It's fine. You can just coast.
I know it's dark humor and shit like that, and I still shouldn't have laughed at it, but good one, Corey.
You don't have to apologize for laughing, Tom. This isn't a fascist state yet, the left.
Are you sure?
Where's my rim shot? There it is.
I mean... They've been telling everybody to stay home for 2 months now, so. I mean, it seems like it's a pretty good case right now for
Texas Theft says, leave that legacy, Tom.
Right. No. Oh, my God.
Corey Adams wrote, Thumb says, he can't even pick a gender.
I'm male.
Yeah, I thought
there's
so
been
too.
No question like that before.
Corey Adams Rogue Thumb says, you stay home. I'm going hitchhiking.
That's a good one with the thumb joke.
Yeah, that's
too.
Pretty,
that's good.
Pretty good.
Pretty
I
solid,
I,
right?
I think I know who this is. I got a very good idea, and I'm just gonna click over here to see. Yeah.
Your old chop.
Oh, I'm pretty sure I know exactly who that is. Oh, maybe not. Maybe I don't, actually. I thought I did. Huh. Wait.
It was nice to hear you guys, you and Chris, relaunching your podcast for a one time only or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I would have rather done an episode, but, like, the guy that, like, has the studio, I mean, so Chris was doing a lot of EMT stuff. And that dude just had a baby, and so their office wasn't letting podcasts, so he's having everybody record at his house. And so
right.
Chris didn't want to be around that house because of the baby and everything.
Yep, that
and
makes
then,
sense.
And then since I reached out to him again, he hasn't got back to me, and so it was like, all right, what do I do? Well, I'll just have Chris on here. I mean, I don't know. I feel like nobody's going to care when shit gets back to normal and we can start pumping out episodes again. I feel like missing stuff during this is not that big of a deal.
Well, I mean, podcasts, like, honestly, like, your unregulated radio, like,
Thing with that. They won't let us in the studio. We're non-essential employees. Everybody else, like, everybody that's not on the pay, like, even the Friday, like, the Justice and Drew show, they're not allowed to have a Friday guest panel anymore.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, because they don't want you to be in, and then they're not going
to
give you...
They just want it down to as little employees as humanly possible.
Yeah, I mean, I listen to... some of the morning shows around town, and basically half their staff is working from home on, like, weird, well, not weird, but makeshift studios in their house. So, but, I mean, that's the whole thing, too. Like, honestly, like, this show would probably be the best for you to even pick up, like, doing all those other shows, like your other podcasts and whatnot.
Well, I mean, yeah. The other thing, too, is that there's more control over it this way. Like, one of the things about this is that, like, I've got a whole brand. I've got the posters, I'm working on the website, which I'm sure will suck. But what I'm really going to do, too, is the website's going to have a forum. How cool is that? No?
It's not that cool.
Damn
you're
it. Okay, first off, fuck you, Tom.
I know.
Second off, it's pretty cool.
It is cool. I just wanted to burst your bubble.
But, like, I'm sure the website will suck because I'm doing it. But, like, the big thing for me is that I've gone through Dirty Bomb Shop now, Chronic Zen... Now, this one, Fraudcast Podcast, Adversarial Libertarian, Sunday Night Fights, Unregulated Radio, and all of them get the things pulled out of them because of something that's out of my control directly. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, right now, we have this coronavirus thing, and I'm not mad. I'm not, like, and with Unregulated Radio, we're doing that in the iHeartRadio place, and they just don't let people in that aren't paid employees, which I think is the right decision. No matter what you think about this coronavirus, if you're a company, cutting it down to only the bare minimum of people that have to be there is exactly the move you want to make.
Yep.
And so I'm not mad about any of that, you know?
Well, and I don't know about iHeartRadio, but I do know that some of the people over at Hubbard that we know have gotten laid off and stuff too. So they're obviously struggling too with just keeping numbers up and then also advertisers up just in this time as well. So. It's getting harder on everybody, man.
Yeah, and I mean, like, whatever. And here's the thing, though, is that, and that's why I like doing that after show with you last night after the post, and, like, why I'm going to do, I got a really cool concept for Steel Toe Brewing, too. I mean, like, the whole thing is that all of this, like, the biggest thing that we should get from this as comics is a way to successfully get our material out to our audiences online without anybody else helping us.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because right now, my whole setup, I mean, beyond the light setup, I mean, I can move all of this in a carry-on if I'm traveling. I could do it from a hotel room when I'm on the road.
Right.
And that's a thing that, you know, once I get the brand image, once I get all this stuff, once I start promoting it real, I mean, this is going to be my major effort point, you know? And
well, if you're worried about lights when you travel, just make sure you take those end table lights and then just prop them up with a pillow and stuff and just have them angle at your face, which no one really wants, but, you know, it's still do that for better lighting and all.
Yeah.
Just to say.
Yeah, I'd agree with all that. Well, okay, so are you feeling a little bit better? Was it a little bit fun to come up here and yell at people?
Yeah, a little bit better.
Good. Thank
you.
Cut yourself some fucking slack, man. Like, this is a really tough time for you. And, like, I mean, I think, like, okay, so permission to talk freely as your friend?
Sure.
I think, like, right now, what you're probably doing is you're beating yourself up over something that's not in your control. And then you're getting mad because you're affected by all this stuff. You know, I mean, like, your mom, this is still a fresh wound. And this is, like you said, it's only the second or third Mother's Day without her. Like,
right.
There's no guide on how to do this. And there's nobody saying when you have to just get over it, you know?
Yep.
And that's the thing is, like, you know, you go at your own pace, but don't, I mean, because the worst thing you can do is start to feel bad for your emotions. And then that just becomes like liquidating your thoughts with booze.
True. Sorry, I started to laugh because of Corey Adams' Rogue Thumbs' latest comment. It was fucking well timed there, dude or missus or whatever the fuck you want to be called.
Cut yourself some slack or just cut yourself. That's pretty good.
Yeah, well timed.
Word. All right, buddy. Well, I'm going to tell everybody where to get a hold of you.
Twitter and Instagram is @TomChilstrom or Facebook.com/Tom.Chilstrom or, as I've said 1,000 times before, just Google Tom Chilstrom with 2 L's and you'll find me.
All right. Are you gonna be in the chat room still?
Yeah, for a little bit longer.
Yeah, get in that chat room. We're gonna call Drew. We're gonna have some fun, man.
Yeah. I mean, I'm gonna watch this KMFDM video just to feel better because it's a better video than what you fucking showed. So
do you need to see the video again?
No, I don't need to see your video. I'm gonna watch the one that it reminds me of that's a better video.
Oh, okay.
It's fucking good.
All right. Well, Godspeed on your better video, Tom.
Yeah, and then I'll get back over to the chat room.
All right. We'll see you in 3 German minutes.
Danke.
Bitte. Auf Wiedersehen. Tschüss. That was Tom Chilstrom. He's not having a good day. We prop him up. Yeah. What else we got here? I know Drew is standing by. Do that. He's real mad about that. All right, fine. We'll just call him right now. Fuck it. You know what? Fuck it.
Oh, what's up, dude?
What up?
A whole lot of nothing, man. I guess getting that loop where I'm still hearing Tom talk.
What? What is Zach yelling in the background? Is that Zach?
Yeah, he said, I'm fixing it.
Tell him to stop fucking loitering on our guests. He already was on this show.
Quit loitering.
Oh, my God, I know, right? Because Tom has never been on more than once.
Did you hear him?
Don't get mad. Don't get mad because Tom's funnier than you, Zach.
Okay. Oh, shit. He said okay.
Yeah, good. How are you? Tell the people who you are and where they can find you.
Hey, everybody. I'm Drew Hatter. You can find me on Instagram, Facebook. Drew Hatter. It's spelled Eher, H-E-H-I-R. I don't know. That's it. Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. It's I guess Drew Haha is also an option.
Drew Haha.
Yeah, it's like Brew Haha, but it's my name.
Okay. I see what you attempted to do there.
Hey, thanks, man. I know, you guys were talking about Phil Coles' puns. I thought that was a pretty solid one, man. That's just what I refer to myself as on the internet.
It's going to be a long interview, isn't it?
I didn't realize it was going to come off as a hack right away. I thought we'd build it.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly, like, I thought we would pull a little wool over some eyes and then reveal it, but nope, just straight to it.
Oh, God damn it, every single time. I can't do interviews anymore. Everyone just knows I'm a fraud before we begin.
What a dork.
That's why I work for family now.
Yeah, all right. So fucking nobody cares. Why aren't you in Germany?
Well, I guess, I don't know. I got a call from my mom to help out at these hotels that my aunt bought in Jamestown, North Dakota. And so instead of going there, I came here to help. And as I pursued going to Germany after coming here, all they told me was I'm not rich enough, essentially. I just need more money in order to get there and live there the way I want.
And now you have a girlfriend there, so you're stuck.
Yeah, essentially. She's got a kid, but it's not mine. So, I mean, it's still possible to break away. But damn.
Sounds like you really believe in this relationship.
You know, I'm trying to do my best in being there for it. It's just, it's
by it, you mean the sentient being that is a kid?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know, man. It's just, I imagine it's got to be rough for the kid, you know? Like, I never had to deal with, like, a divorce.
Yeah, like a mom dumb enough to date you?
Yeah, dude, 100%. I don't know, my dad just died to get away from me, so it's like, I don't have to deal with having
what
to
did you just say?
My dad died just to get away from me. I didn't have to deal with, like, the divorce. It was just over.
Yeah, I mean, he left most of what he had, but he got the fuck out.
he knew what was best.
So why is Zach up there? We're supposed to be social distancing, and that fucking hippie's up there?
Yeah, dude, I don't know, man. He was having a weekend, and I told him, hey, man, if you want, you can just come up here. I got him a room at the hotel, even though he's been spending most of the time in my room. Because
you guys fuck.
I mean, sure, I got a lady friend, but she's in California, so I got to fuck something.
Yeah. Where did he go? Is he gone already?
No, he's just...
Oh, I thought I was supposed to remain quiet because I've already been on the show.
Oh, yeah? Did you also think you should forbiddenly talk like a D-bag? Or is that just some sweet ad-libs?
That was just me being a fucking sweet entertainer.
Yeah? Oh, yeah? Zach, what the fuck are you doing up there? What is wrong with you?
I'm making shots right now.
How drunk are you on a scale of 1 to Joey Coco?
About a 6 out of 10, bud. But here's the thing. I came up here just because, you know, like, currently my living situation is trash, and I didn't want to deal with it. And
oh,
this
shit.
COVID-
yeah, you fucking hate that shit. You were hating that shit for a while.
No, I know. I'm still stuck there. But here's the thing. I don't think this whole COVID thing, like, I think, like, honestly, the first stay-at-home order was, like, really a natural ending to it. It's what the CDC recommended at first. And, you know, if we really look at it globally, I was like, you know, who gives a shit? Like,
excuse me, bitch.
Like, smoke under this vent. We're smoking cigarettes. Hang on. But if this is what it is, I was like, well, I'm just going to go see my buddy Droopy. His lady's out of town. And, you know, it's a good time to just kick it and do a friender bender and get shit faced. So that's what we're doing.
Did you just say friender bender?
Yeah. Friender bender, dude.
Hey, dude, your Rochester is showing. Shut the fuck up. Friender bender? That's some, like, Mayo Clinic doctors trying to be cool talk right there.
It's fine.
There is somebody in the chat room named Ganja right now.
That's great, dude. I wonder if he smokes weed.
Yeah, what if he didn't? No, I never touched the stuff.
It'd be so great, dude. It's fucking Nancy Reagan. She's pulling the mask off.
Isn't she dead?
Oh, long time. The both of them, yeah.
So yeah, why? Wait. So you wait? Okay, Drew. We'll get to you in a second. Zach.
Yeah.
Why don't you just move somewhere else? You've hated living there forever.
That's the thing, man. Like, I've honestly been looking at other places that aren't necessarily even in the cities. Like, I'd love to stay in the cities and keep working the scene there, but believe it or not, it can get toxic at times and a little bit small-minded.
Wait.
You know
what gets toxic?
The comedy scene in Minneapolis.
No way. So, it seems so friendly and encouraging to me.
I look at places like Seattle, New York, where I've got family out there, and I just think to myself sometimes, why the fuck not? I got no strings on me, dude. Why not do it? But
I don't know, though. It's pretty nice to not be there right now.
Well, right, but I mean, give it fucking 6 months, you know?
Maybe, or 2 years.
Well, that's what they say, but again, you really think we're going to go through the ebbs and flows like it's the goddamn bubonic plague?
I do. No, check it out. I do, and I'll tell you why. Ready? There's still SARS-1. They never cured SARS-1, and now they're talking about curing SARS-2. Like, that's not how it works. There's no vaccine. No, that's insane.
No, and I'm not on the vaccine train, buddy. I'm just saying the natural pandemics have a way of sort of, especially on this level of a global death rate, they have a way of working themselves out, like Spanish flu, avian flu, swine flu, which I personally fucking caught way back when it actually existed. I worked in a call center and it went around. But, like, the thing about COVID that's interesting is, you know, people are treating it like you're going to catch buboes and shit. Then the vast
Did you just say buboes? Like,
buboes, like the bubonic plague. Like, you get the,
like, you're on such a good thing that, like, that's just what it is. Buboes.
Well, that's what they're called. They were called buboes. You got a bubo, which looked like a big fucking black sack hanging off of you. It'd be in your groin and your armpit somewhere, and that's how they knew you were going to die of black death. But here's the thing. We don't have a death rate like that. This isn't killing 20 to 55-year-old people. We're talking people who have compromised immune systems. We're talking the vast majority of people who have died would have died from anything else fucking in that nursing home anyway. You know, so to go around like we're warding off and we need to all have medals pinned on our chest for jerking off at home is getting a bit redundant to me. So I don't know.
Well, just because you're over it doesn't mean it's done. I mean, that's like, I don't know, that's like insane, I guess.
Well, I mean, is it though? Because we've had 250,000 people die on the face of the planet Earth within 4 months, and believe it or not, lots of people die of lots of different things every day in much greater fucking numbers.
Get
so
the fuck out of here. Are you trying to tell me that people die every day?
Oh, shit!
Whoa, shocking.
Wait, what?
Shocking. Anyway, I'm going to pour more shots. I'm up for that.
No, I want to, like, this is, like, you, like, how far of a drive is that?
5 hours.
Right, like, this is how much you hate your house, dude. You drove 5 hours to get the fuck away from it.
Or it's how much he just really wanted to see.
I just want to see my buddy, dude.
Look.
Staying a Super 8 for free, dude. But also, I did, like, 3.5 hours of metal screaming on the way, so it was really good to get the practice in. I'm not gonna fucking lie.
Yeah, you're right. That metal screaming is not because of your angry environment.
Dude, you should hear me do some death clock songs, man. I fucking nail it, dude. The hammer, I get in. I'll fucking crush that song.
Play Murmurder or get the fuck out, bro.
That's the best album, I'm not gonna lie.
Oh yeah, that first album is the best. That might be the best metal album ever.
Yeah. Fan Song is great. That's probably my favorite one off that. Fan Song is just so good.
Just move out, Zach. Don't, like, stop fucking driving 5 hours to get away. And Drew, move back here. That's it. Everybody wins.
That's what I've been trying to argue with this guy. You have no idea.
Oh, you think I don't have an idea? I fucking told this guy not to move because he would never fucking leave there.
Yeah, now I'm assistant manager of these hotels.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and you have a girl. You're an assistant manager. I mean, you just live there now. That's just who you are. That's your life.
It's weird because I'm living in a hotel.
That's actually kind of awesome. It's like the best Newhart episode ever.
Plus, in his room, he's got a big TV like he's a pit boss with all the cameras for the whole hotel so I can watch people go from room A to room B. Goddamn, I feel powerful. I feel powerful.
So you basically are like the back end of a strip club. That's what your room is?
Kind of, yeah.
All right. Enough of you, Zach. Drew, how are you doing?
No, man, not too bad. So
how long did you do comedy when you were here?
I mean, I guess close to 5 years. Sure. Coming up on 5 years.
And how many mics have you hit since you moved up there?
I mean, I go to Fargo every Wednesday, or I was going to Fargo every Wednesday for their mics. Because they've got a great room out here at the Cellar. I'll plug it at the Front Street Tavern.
Sure.
It's fantastic. But other than that, they only have like a mic on Tuesdays at the Red Raven, and then the Wednesday.
Wait. The Red Raven is still going on?
Yep.
That's amazing. That's like the little bar venue that could.
Yeah, dude. And now they're just like a coffee shop. And David Standel, who's a really good Fargo comedian.
What's the Fargo scene like these days?
Yo, man. It's pretty impressive. Like, John Kennedy won the Fargo's, like, funniest. Mm-hmm. And he opened up for Joel McHale and Moshe Kesher while they were here. And he's unbelievable. I know he's been making trips to Minneapolis, so I hope you take notice.
John Kennedy's good.
Dude, he's great. But I mean, it's John Kennedy. I get people in Fargo saying that I'm their favorite. They refer to me as the high hotel guy based on the newer jokes I was working on since I moved out.
You should
out
change
here.
That to your name, dude. Drew High Hotel is so much funnier.
Drew High Hotel.
Yeah.
See, my bit involves living at the Super 8 life of Drew. Like, I don't know. I'm working on like a podcast of my own, but I don't know how I'm going to take it yet.
Instead of Nancy Drew, it's Drew the Nancy.
If only.
Yeah, he is.
And that's a guy. That's a guy that drives 5 hours away to get away from home. Think about that, Drew.
Oh fuck! If I'm getting called a Nancy by a Nancy,
now I just want a fist fight to break out in the background.
Yo, I can't talk. I'm fighting Zach right now.
Yeah, oh, man, sorry. I've been waiting for this interview, but I really got to fucking fight Zach right now.
Yo, we're gonna have
what's the crazy? Okay, so fuck comedy. You're not a comic anymore. I'm sorry that somebody had to break it to you like this, but that's what happens.
I get it.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool. You're still, like, cool, and, like, you'll probably be allowed back in a couple green rooms, but it's over for you. Sorry. Like, you don't even care if you go to Germany anymore, right? Germany was just one of those things just to get the fuck out?
I mean, I still want to go there. I have, like, my exchange family there, and technically my exchange brother is now in Switzerland. But, I don't know, German's that language I learned. I put a lot of effort into being a part of that German culture, and I'd still like to go. It just, now it's a matter of when I get there.
Yeah, the time to go was like fucking 6 months ago.
Yeah, then I could have been stuck there. It'd have been perfect.
Yeah, there's no coming back then. Oh, I just have to live with my mistakes. I like this.
Yo,
good thing you don't know anything about that in North Dakota. I honestly, like, ball busting aside, I bet that's fucking weird and fun, like working at a hotel.
Yeah, it's not bad. I mean, Jamestown is a meth town. If you've ever been to one. And
wait. A meth town?
Oh shit.
Meth town. Yeah, it's full of meth. And we get people who will stay here and, like, they're really shady, man. There's a big difference between people who smoke weed and the people who do meth. The biggest difference is people who do meth think everything is sketchy and they act sketchier because of it.
You are fake dude.
We people who think it's sketchy, they are just high.
Yeah.
It's so bad.
Well, a lot of the listeners here are up from St. Cloud, and Doima points out St. Cloud is a meth town and it's way closer.
Yeah, I didn't move out here for the meth. Let's not get
don't lie, yes you did.
I heard their meth is so good here, man. That keeps people coming.
Hey man, hey, you got any of that Williston Itchy 218? I love that shit. They used to be a boom town, but now they're a spoon town.
Oh, fuck, that
that's
so
a that's dumb. A her- that's a heroin joke.
I couldn't tell.
Good.
But no, dude, I don't know. I live in the manager suite, so now I've got like a studio apartment technically. Which is nice because before I was living with Daryl Horner and other comics and just people, and I was sick of.
It's kind of funny that both you and Zach have to go to a fucking Super 8 to get away from people.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I'm sick of living with all these people. I better go live in this motel.
Oh, this hotel is calling my name.
Why do you keep calling your motel a hotel?
Well, because it's a hotel. If you look up hotels on Jamestown, my hotels pop up.
What's the difference? Like, a hotel just has two stories?
Maybe. I don't know. There's, like, the Buffalo Motel in town, and that one looks sketchy. Zach and I drove by it earlier, and he was like, yo, that one looks fucked up.
I lived in a trailer. I grew up in a trailer park, and it looks
sketchy.
Oh,
yeah, Zach, we couldn't have told that.
I just thought
the long-haired scream metal singer that drives 5 hours to get drunk with his friend because he can't tell his roommates he wants to move came from a trailer park? Weird.
It's not that I don't want to tell them I don't want to move. It's that I can't afford to move. Get real with the economy, bro.
Get real with the economy, bro.
I was supposed to be coming back in June.
Why don't you move back and just live with Zach?
I mean, that was kind of the plan. Is I was going to move back, and it was going to be Zach, Trevor, and myself, and we were going to get a spot. But with all the COVID and all that shit, I don't really want to move until there's a real okay to do different.
How many times do you think Trevor has convinced himself he has the Rona right now?
Oh, man. I mean, I would only guess a few times, but I think Zach would know that better.
There are some fucking horror stories I could tell and I'm drunk and I want to.
Yes. Yes. Come on. What's wrong with you? What the fuck is wrong with you? Why would you do that?
No, you got it.
Yeah.
Come on. Horror story. Horror story.
All right. So when this all... Oh, Jesus. All right. So when this all started, believe it or not, I was pulling with this fucking chick who was super fine. I'm talking goth chick, everything's pierced, everything looks good. All right, pour them shots then. Well, all right, then that's yours. But all right, so everything was cool, and I had her over just for an afternoon because obviously neither one of us have fucking coronavirus. Get fucking real.
Well, I don't know, man. They're saying it transfers through sex, so yeah, you're probably safe.
Whatever. But all right, so I had her over, and they threw this big fucking fit at me, dude. Like, they threw this fucking epic, I need to get my shit together, you gotta do this, that, the other, this is a serious thing. Why don't
just because you were getting some tail?
Just because I had a girl over for 3 hours that I ain't seen in a fucking month who, like, I wanted to see, you know what I'm saying? And, like, it got...
3 hours, man. How far are you fucking rounding up, you fucking jerkbag?
No, I'm telling you, deadass, like, that was the amount of time because I even had to make it like that. Like, dude, like, literally before I left, I legit felt like I felt like I lived with my fucking parents. Like, they were
really
talking to me.
And that was all of your roommates?
Man, like, I was a fucking child, dude. And I was like, fuck, are you fucking kidding me, dude?
Well, and you I got to say, like, you have, like, so I'm going to tell you something that you might not like, but it's something that I know about you, right?
Okay.
You have something inside you where I don't know what happened. I don't know what the genesis of this is, right? But there is a point where when somebody talks down to you, that, like, rubs you wrong in a way that not... Like, I feel like somebody could punch you in the face and you would care less about it than when people actually talk down to you.
Yes. Yes, dude. Because at least that guy who hit me in the face wasn't playing Minnesota nice. They weren't putting a fucking mask on before they tried to fucking sell you.
I put your picture on here, too, and I managed to use the real mean one, so you're good.
You know what I'm saying? Like, don't you fucking sell me a bridge with a goddamn mask on that has a fake face on it. I'd rather you just come up and hit me in the face if you got a fucking problem.
Sure.
And then we'll sort it. You know what I mean?
What do you think is, like, the genesis of that? Because, like, I mean, you'll fucking pop off on my... I remember one of the biggest times you and I got into it, you got mad because I was busy and I was real short with you because I was running around, and you thought it was, like, a personal attack, which, like, it was dismissive and it was my bad, but I was just busy. And we talked later and stuff, but, like, I've never seen you mad like that. It's just, it's really weird.
Yeah, dude, I think it's just, it comes from a place of, you know, and it's, I think it's the culture that gets bred when you are white trash. I'm not going to lie. White trash.
Hey, I'm like, white trash too, man. You're talking from a guy who was born in Hibbing, dude.
Nah, I mean, and we get it, though. Like, listen, say what you fucking mean, and if you got a problem, fucking vocalize it. But if you're going to dance around the issue or you're going to dismiss me to my face, I'm going to be like, all right, then let's fucking pick a hand, dude, because, like, I'm not going to be...
I hope you
treated.
Like patty cake, because catch these hands.
Right. Exactly, dude. Like, and I'm not a big fucking dude. I know I'm not a scary fucking man. I'm not going to win most of the fights that I'm in. But, like, you know, be real. Be real with me. You know, like, if you have a problem, say it's my face, and we'll fucking either talk about it or we'll sort it. But,
it does,
you know,
it does seem like your house has, like, condescending parent vibes.
Are you fucking kidding me, dude? Like, we're talking about people, and this is my life situation, and I really hope they're not listening, but I also don't give a shit if they are. But you can't treat people a certain way because that's what you expect life to be. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like,
you have to acknowledge people are people, so
yeah.
Why should it be that you and I should get along so awfully?
Yeah, what do you know? I mean, but at the same time, you know, but it's because they won't be real with you. Like, they'll put these fucking sock and bopper kitty boxing gloves on and try and bop you in the face with, like, fucking underhanded. It's called Minnesota Nice, but I don't remember who had the bit about it, but it's just called being a fucking asshole. Like, it's being an undercutting, passive-aggressive asshole. It's the passive-aggressive Olympics. And that's literally what our state is actually built on. And it's disgusting, dude. Like, you just – once you see through the cracks, you're like, man, fuck you. And plus, you know, I grew up on punk rock and metal, and, like, that's what I really wanted to do with my life. So when I hear people talking out the fucking sides of their mouth, I want to slap it back on straight. Like, get fucking real with me, man, you know? So that's why I drove 5 hours to get drunk. There you go.
Yeah, so now it's just like, that's got to be weird though, man, because like now you realize that you can drive to a five-hour-away meth town to hang out with your friend who's a loser from North Dakota and lives in a motel, and somehow it feels like being more of an adult than staying around with that garbage.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel more free. I wrote 2 full fucking songs today.
All right, where's Drew? Drew, are you on there?
No, he actually has to go work the front desk of this hotel. I'm watching him do it on these fucking monitors right now.
This is amazing.
He actually left the room and said, kept talking, so that's what I was doing. But
give us the play-by-play of him working at the hotel. I think this is hilarious.
I guarantee you I will. He's talking to a man in a blue shirt, button up. He looks like Scott Peterson. Mm-hmm. You remember Scott Peterson who killed his wife?
Yep.
He looks just like that fucking guy, but he's wearing glasses.
Over under that this dude killed his wife.
He's the same height as Drew, which makes me think his wife could have overpowered him.
Okay. That's fair. I like the sleuthing. Got some skills.
And then there's another guy in the lobby who's watching an actual slideshow of the local what's that shit where it's like come worship with us on Sunday.
Oh, gross. Or, gross.
You know what I mean? He's staring at it. He's drinking a cup of
Ellie,
coffee.
Ellie May 612 says Minnesota Nice is the worst.
It is the goddamn worst, dude. Like, fuck that shit. Take the mask off and be real with me if you got something to say.
I know that the culture's like that and they fucking do it, but, like, do you remember when you were a kid, was there a specific instance where you're like, no, daddy doesn't play this anymore. Get fucked.
Yeah. I think the worst, I mean, if you want to get heavy, dude, so my dad was a major in the United States Army. He did 3 tours in Iraq, 1 in Desert Storm,
sure.
2 for Iraq.
So no way, no chance he spanked you as a kid.
No. Here's the thing. My dad would lay hands on me now and then, but for the most part he didn't need to because his job was to shout at full-grown men and make them cry hard enough to shoot more bullets. So believe it or not, a goth kid who's 15, you don't have to yell at him that hard.
Did you cry in front of your dad a lot?
No, actually, because that's a sign of weakness. I cry in front of my mom, but again, you know, that's now and then shit. You know,
yeah.
Now and then shit.
Yeah.
Because you're not supposed to cry. You're not supposed.
No,
to.
Absolutely. I was actually talking to somebody about this where they're like, well, it's okay to cry. I go, yeah, but the programming's already there. And if you were born in the 80s at all, you don't cry.
No.
You don't
do
that.
And that I was born in 1990, but trust me, man.
Same thing. Well, when you say eras, it's usually going up to like the 2s to 4s. So like if you're born 1994 and back, you don't cry. If you're a dude, not allowed.
Right. Not at all. And on top of that,
culture changed and now it's different, but like it's not, you know?
Right. But now we're in a culture of, and I worked in the school system, so I kind of know like, it's like we have to validate students or children's feelings no matter what.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, well, that's what they feel, so we have to respect that. And you go, ah, because there's varying levels of suffering, isn't there? Like, somebody was mean to you on Facebook is one thing. Your dad comes home from Iraq and goes, your mom's a fucking whore and punches you in the mouth because he doesn't want to fucking deal with you. That's a bit different. You know, we grew up in different sort of eras, I guess.
Tom Chilstrom says, way to brag about a mom, asshole.
Oh, my God, does Tom not have a mom?
Tom's mom died, and this is his third Mother's Day without a mom, and he was on earlier taking it really hard. So I want you to know you might have been the thing that pushes Tom over the edge.
Tom, I am so sorry to hear. I'm genuinely sorry to hear that, man. That's
take off your mask, Zach. You don't have to hide behind your bullshit.
Apology accepted.
No, I mean it. I mean it. That's terrible.
This is what Minnesota nice means to me. It means, like, apologizing because your friend's mom's dead even when you don't mean it. Zach Ashton style.
I mean it. I can feel his feelings. But at the same time, like, there's a difference between feeling your friend's feelings and actually saying sorry.
I think that needs to be the name of your first solo album. Feel His Feelings.
Nah, man. So, like, the first, all right, if I want to do a comedy album, I don't
know. No, metal. That's the metal name.
No, the metal
your
one.
Your solo metal name is Feel His Feelings.
No, man, I was high out of my mind on Oxycontin and a bunch of fucking vodka after, like, a rehearsal one day, and I thought, injections without questions.
That's pretty
that
good.
That was going to be the best. I was like, dude, and then we'd have, like, the cover album, like, somebody ripping a baby out of a fucking anti-vaxxer mom's arms and, like, shoving a needle in them with, like, a big American flag behind it. It's going to be sick, dude.
Matt Doima says a metal cover of Can I Borrow a Feeling?
Actually, I was going to work with Joe Cocozillo on a project where we were going to put me in a sound booth, and I was just going to do a bunch of metal screaming to a bunch of weird songs that don't need them, like Chumbawamba or like Disney shit, and just make them like metal covers, and I thought that would be fun, but it never
Tom,
really came to
Tom Chilstrom says he hates you, Zach, and he'll never forgive you.
That's okay. I understand. I mean,
I'm actually kidding. He just said he loves you.
Oh, okay. I was going to say you can't win them all. You can't win them all. It's like Gary Anderson. You can't miss. You can't make every kick, can you? You fucking fail.
Oh, man. You want to know the funny thing about that? Like, do you know who my other team is?
What's your B team?
Well, I mean, they're both A teams, but 49ers. When I was a kid, I lived in Oregon, and the 49ers were the closest team that wasn't the Seahawks. But the long story longer, Gary Anderson used to play for the Niners. I watched that motherfucker not miss a kick for like 8 years. And then he missed that kick.
He played for the Niners?
Yeah, that's who we got. That's who the Vikings got him from. Like, I'd say Vikings are A, Niners are B at this point. But, I mean,
yeah,
I like them both. And, to me, I've always rooted for the Vikings against the Niners because the Vikings don't have a Super Bowl.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, if they play head-to-head, I will always – like, actually, it was really crazy because I went and watched the playoff game with them, and I'm just sitting there in my Viking jersey rooting for them, and Tom's like, not one fucking word.
Can you actually picture the riot that we're going to have when they finally hoist one? It won't be with Kirk. I have literally been against the Kirk Cousins deal since the day he fucking
got
here.
Like, I'm not mad about it. My only problem is that if you're going to get
a sack of shit, dude. He's a sack of shit.
So listen,
he makes
every Madden game that I buy
harder to play.
He's not.
Because I have to find a way to offload this giant turd onto some computer team for millions of fucking dollars. Dude.
I don't agree with any of that, but that's fine. I think that he does get paid too much. He is a top 10 quarterback and has been his entire career.
Why is he getting paid like a top three? Why is he getting paid like a top three?
But he's not. Like, he was just the first to sign that contract. Like, he's like eight now. Like, I mean, it's as the other, like, he was the first quarterback to sign under the new collective agreement thing. So his giant contract is what a standard contract looks like. And, like, Brady's making more, Rodgers is making more. Every major quarterback that's signed since then is making more than him.
We're legitimately talking about a guy who will never complete over 70% of his passes, and he will never throw more than 35 touchdowns in a season.
I disagree with that entirely.
Quote me on it. Quote me on it. He's never done it. He never will.
He's going to do it this year, dude.
No.
Yeah. We're going undefeated to the Super Bowl. It's this year.
No. Bro, he'll take you to a wild card round, and then he'll lose it in front of the whole fucking nation, and then he'll take his stupid chiseled fucking jawline and his goddamn steel blue eyes and go, well, God just didn't want us to win this one. Like, fuck you, man. Come on now.
This is our year, man. We're tied for first, undefeated. We got this.
Now, I was literally of the mind, because you don't have the money to do it now, but you should have. We should have signed Cam Newton. Could you imagine fucking running an offense with Cam Newton? I mean, we don't have Stephon anymore because he went to my beach.
What we should have done is we should have not signed. We should have not signed Cousins, and we should have aggressively gone after Foles this last offseason.
Absolutely. Well, here's the problem. You run into the same situation that you ran into with Bradford. Goddamn, he looks good. But one guy comes off the edge on that shitty offensive line, clips him in the knee, and you're going to miss him for 12 weeks. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
But in Foles' case, I mean, he's super durable. Like, he played most that season because fucking their star guy got injured.
He's not that durable. He's not that durable.
I don't know. He's durable enough to win a Super Bowl.
Well, right. He won 3 games in a row and took him – you know what I mean? Like, but – we're talking an 18-week season. I don't know about that.
My thing with Cousins is, like, no matter what you think about him as his playing ability, you definitely aren't going to punch a passing quarterback into a running team. That's stupid.
No, and it makes no sense. And then on top of all that,
but
I
love that we went out and got that wide receiver, man. This shit's going to be fucking awesome.
Same.
I think we're going to be, like, we got the young fucking corner that we needed. We got the fucking wide receiver, and then we went heavy on the line. I love what we did, and I think you're going to be shocked when fucking Cousins – because, like, here's the thing about Cousins, and this is the thing that no Viking fan wants to talk about and no Viking fan wants to realize, but Stephon Diggs was a cancer. He just was. That dude was throwing fits in games that we were winning.
I know.
Hear me out. Hear me out, right? The thing about cancers is that there's a chemistry that gets established, right? There were times that Cousin was looking off Diggs because he was a prick. And that's not going to happen anymore because we have a different guy. And I think you're going to see Cousin's numbers. I don't think they'll double, but I think he's going to have a better year than he had last year. And again, if you look at the stats, as much as you hate the guy, his career average for seasons is pretty – he's like Peyton Manning. He's literally like a shittier Peyton Manning. He's Peyton Manning. He's fucking like he'll put up all the averages. He's not going to win you those big games, but he's also not going to lose them.
Listen, so update, Drew is back. I'm going to give you back to him, but here's the last thing I want to say. Like, the thing about Kirk Cousins that I can respect, and I'm going to play devil's advocate even against myself, the thing I can respect is he's got that Tom Brady, Peyton Manning, like you said, you can't go broke taking a profit. Like, he's not going to throw passes that are 35, 45 yards down the field, but he'll dink and dunk you. 6 yards, 7, back to 4, now 6, now 3, now 5 again. Like, he'll dink and dunk you down the field, but I just don't think that that's going to win you Super Bowls. I think you need a guy who can extend plays, and I just don't think that's him. You know?
I agree with most of what you just said, but I think that this year is the, like, put up or shut up, prove it year, you know, but I don't like, absolutely. I don't know. I see why you think that, but I think the same thing that I thought last year, our career, like our season trajectory, right. Mm-hmm. Is more dependent on Cook than it is our quarterback.
Absolutely. Well, it's on the offensive line. If they can open holes for Cook.
For sure.
That's the question.
For sure. I agree.
All right,
with that.
Here you go. 1 second, buddy. Here's
yep.
Oh, hey.
What up, guy?
I had a feeling for sure there were going to be guests and I had to deal with it.
Yeah, no, that was fine. We actually, when I went to go cut back to you, you were already helping somebody.
Oh, perfect. Was Zach, decent enough for you? Was he okay?
Not really. I got him to talk Vikings, which was okay, but, like, mainly I just want to belittle him for, like, I know you guys are friends, and I know that's your boy, and I'm not trying to belittle you, but, like, how sad is it when a grown man has to drive 5 hours to feel at home in a hotel?
Yeah, with another just, like, guy friend that he... you know, believes to be straight.
Yeah. No, he's not. You're not allowed. You're not allowed back home. We told you, Zach, if you're going to be out past sunset, you stay out till dawn.
He's ignoring you now at this point.
That'll happen. How's work? Pretty good. So what's the craziest thing you've seen running that hotel?
Man, we had a fentanyl bust not too long ago.
What? Wait, yeah, hold on. Say it again. We're getting sound effects this time.
We had a fentanyl bust.
Oh, shit! Oh, shit!
Okay, so here's what we're going to do, right? I have got to go to the bathroom. You tell these people about the fentanyl bust, and I'll be right back. But I'll be watching on my phone, so I'll hear you.
Well, so you'll know if I'm talking shit. Fair enough.
I don't actually do that, but don't talk shit. I'll be right back. Tell them about the fentanyl. All
right. Yo, now that Corey's gone, can't you believe that he's such a prick? No, all right. The fentanyl boss was nuts. Apparently, they're, you know, Jamestown being the meth town, meth is everywhere, and the people really enjoy it here. And we get people into our hotels who are not on our not spell list because they know that we've got that working, so they keep sending in a new person. And there was this one guy who wasn't quite on the list yet, but he was a big meth dealer in the town. And apparently his fentanyl killed 5 people in town. So he checked into our hotels. He had people coming in and out of the room all night. And suddenly I was face to face with like 4 Jamestown sheriffs. And they raided the room. They pulled like 8 people out of the room, which I didn't even know how 8 people got there. 2 cars showed up and 8 people were in his room, and they pulled him out. There were people all over the place. And I don't know, the guy got out of jail 3 days later, and I'm sure is back out on these streets running more product. And that's really all it came down to. Just Jamestown, I don't know what it is about them. They care more about the cars they drive than the drugs they want to pick up. It's fucking Jamestown. Come on, we got to be done with taking a piss by now. How is that impossible?
That's fucking crazy.
Right?
Yeah. That's not only is that a crazy story, but I timed that fucking perfect.
I heard you listening to it, so it worked out really well.
Yeah, it's pretty fine. I have prostate cancer. Okay. Tovar has really been rooting against me lately. He's been saying I need glasses, now I have prostate cancer. This shit sucks.
You know why that is though, man. You don't have a fucking Xbox, and you should.
You know what you did to you.
Why would I have an Xbox? That's for losers.
Hey, man. Who's to say you're not a loser? What do you mean?
Me, because I own a PS4.
God, sounds like a loser to me. You better hurry up and commit
you're right,
to an
you're
Xbox.
Right. You're right. Who wants to play all of the top 10 games of the year when we can just justify having an inferior console because of Forza and Halo? Get fucked.
Wait, is that it? They PS4's got the top 10 best games of the year?
PS4 has routinely 5 games in the top 10 every year as console exclusives.
Okay.
Like like Spider-Man, that was exclusive to PlayStation.
Yeah,
God of War was exclusive to PlayStation. Horizon Zero Dawn was exclusive to PlayStation.
And I haven't played that one, but I hear that one's fucking awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, Days Gone, Last of Us. It goes on and on and on. And the more the people on Xbox try to convince you that that's the console, just keep reminding them, yeah, I guess it's the console if you don't want to play the best games. Because, again, the only thing Xbox has is they have Forza, which is awesome. Forza is hands down the best racing game on the planet, period.
Yeah.
But the and Halo is a good show. I don't really like Halo, but, I mean, like, I do like Forza. But playing the difference between Forza and Gran Turismo – to me, does not negate, because I don't play racing games that much. If I played them like Tovar, I mean, I get why Tovar does. If I was a car guy, sure. I mean, nobody, like, Forza is literally the best car game ever made. It always has been.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're in it for anything but Forza or Halo, there's no real reason to be on anything but PS4, because other than that, most of the exclusive Xbox titles suck, and all of the PlayStation exclusives are really, really good.
I get that. And to be honest, I've wanted a PS4 for so long, but I had originally gotten an Xbox One. I don't know, I think my first year at the U of M when I got my student loans, instead of buying textbooks, I got an Xbox One.
Well, the other thing, too, is that I had an Xbox 360 that Red Ring, so I'll never buy an Xbox product again.
He agrees with you, but he's got to go help more fucking methed out truckers at the old Econo Lodge. Hello.
Hi, how's it going? Are you back?
I am back, dude. I am back.
How does it make you feel?
Anything in the world, go.
Anything in the world, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Huh.
I'm drunk. I'll legit.
No, I know you will. I'm trying to really abuse this.
Okay. Do you want like Jeopardy music or like?
I'm playing Jeopardy music. You just can't hear it.
Okay.
All the sound effects are gone. I'm just kidding. There's no sound effects. Are you like legit? Why are you driving 5 hours to get away from your fucking house, man? Just like fucking get a room and stay away from there, dude. It's fucking weird.
No, man, again, because, like, honestly, Drew is, like, a genuine, solid, gold human being, and, like, sometimes when I want to get away and just talk to somebody, I know that he's somebody who won't fucking judge some shit and, like, take it the wrong way. Like, you can just be open and honest with him. But also, at the same time, like, I just wanted to get away from everything, man. Like, it was worth it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I feel like there's a lot of not being honest with yourself in that, but I don't have enough time left to pick apart
no,
that wound.
No, I'll be honest with myself. Like, I didn't want to just, like, are you kidding me, dude? I did it a whole month by myself, fucking sitting around, jerking off, playing Xbox, sitting in the same fucking place. Like, why would you want to do more of that, you know?
You're just over it.
I'm so fucking over it, dude. Are you kidding me? I watched 2 whole seasons of My 600-Pound Life, and every episode is the exact goddamn same. Okay, like, I got diddled by my stepdad. Now I'm fat. Like, that's the whole thing. Men, women, all of them. Gross stepdads, apparently.
Okay. Is that why you always think you're fat?
I honestly don't. I think that I could gain a few more pounds, like Mac from It's Always Sunny, and then just turn it into fucking bulk. You know what I'm saying?
Matt Doima said he wanted to get away, but Southwest was unavailable.
Matt Doima wants to get away from everything, and I understand it, Matt. I understand it, okay? It's terrible.
Prop me up beside the jukebox says, change the scenery is nice.
It really is, man. And, like, here's the thing about North Dakota. I didn't know that they had lakes. They have, like, these weird man-made lakes that are the exact same water level as the roads, which will trip you out. Which makes me think that did they dig them out? He's back, by the way. Did they dig out those lakes, or are those, like, actual natural things?
I think they're man-made.
Me too.
This is getting real fascinating, gentlemen. I'm gonna get going, though. I gotta run.
Wow, okay.
What? What?
As soon as I get back.
What?
I feel like half of my time with you has been spent with Zach, and I'm so sorry about that.
I'm actually glad about that, Drew.
You son of a bitch. Why'd you say that? Why would you hurt me, man?
Yeah, I just want, you know, it's been a long quarantine. I need to lash out. You were there. Feel the knuckles. Blah, blah, blah.
Hey, man, I'm all about it, but it would make more sense if you had an Xbox so you could kill me on Xbox.
Shit, should we ask more general questions about MMA? Would that keep us on longer?
Yeah, if we start talking about fights.
All right, you know what? Fine. You know what? I was going to show a video, but we're already getting close to time anyways. Fuck it. You guys are on now. Here we go. We're back in it. We're in it to win it. Here we go. How's it going?
Oh, not too bad. Pretty decent.
Yeah. Drew, are you ever moving back down to Minneapolis?
You know, I really want to. My, like I said, my original plan was to come back in June, but now with COVID, I just would rather be.
August, bitch.
I'd rather be safe about it than fuck around.
That makes sense.
Not that I think I'll get it. Apparently, Italians are the main, like, attack group. I don't know why, but anyone with, like, Italian descent is getting most of it. So I don't know how you don't.
Dirty Guido.
Wait, is that true?
Yeah, I guess, man. I don't know. This is something that my mom said, and everything she says is right all the time.
All right. No, that's fair. I'm actually gonna Google now Italians and COVID because now I'm paranoid.
You're gonna get a bunch of articles about Italy and how they did.
Italian. Hold on. COVID.
I think it's that she just might have known someone who was Italian who also got COVID, and that was enough for to convince her to believe it.
Tovar says, I heard Italians without Xbox are definitely getting COVID.
100% of them, man. It's really weird.
That's okay. So I'm the statistical outlier at that point.
Yeah, yeah. We're not. Hey, we're not trying to get you an Xbox just to play with you. We just want you to get an Xbox so you're safe, man. We care.
Okay, that's.
We go. How is he gonna keep doing his thing if he doesn't have an Xbox or COVID?
Yeah. Also, today looks like one of the lowest totals of deaths we've ever had, FYI.
Like, in general, across the globe, or just in...
No. In America, today was the lowest death count we've had since March 29th.
Oh, really?
Yeah. 750 today.
Gotcha. Wow, no one else died? That's so great.
That's just what... Yeah, just 750 people.
Just a few of us.
That's no big deal.
We didn't need those anymore.
Tovar said, it's the only time Corey get an Xbox before you choke to death on your own lung fluid. Yeah, I'm in, I guess. You know what? I really misjudged this whole Xbox thing, guys. I guess I'm totally on board. And I want you to know that this is a heartfelt testimonial and not because there was a great personal threat to my safety. I just think that it's a superior counsel, despite everything I've said to the contrary. Like, right now, when I found out I was at risk by not having one, is the only time I could really realize how important it was that I partake in what is clearly a better gaming console.
You've heard, I think it's Bill Gates, who was like creating a vaccine or whatever.
Yep.
Yeah. And he owns Microsoft. Yo, you might as well jump on board. The antidote for COVID is in the Xbox.
That's going to be it. Yeah, the Red Ring of Death is just for people that don't own the council anymore.
You got it, man.
That's fucking scary shit, man. That is scary fucking shit. Prop Me Up Besides the Jukebox says, it's a Mother's Day miracle. Yeah, it is a Mother's Day miracle that for some reason I don't have the COVID. The COVID, y'all.
Is your mother still with us? Is she still around?
I mean, she lives in Florida, so not really.
Yeah, I was about to say no. She might as well.
No, yeah, she's still alive and kicking. I talked to her today.
Good, good. I was going to say, did you send her anything for Mother's Day or anything like that?
No, I sent her a text message saying Happy Mother's Day.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah,
that's
not
bad. As far as things go, that's all you really need to do. Acknowledge.
Cabra Hunting says, console, not council. What, console, council, it's all the same, Doc. Calm down.
Yeah, well, I heard you say council too, but I wasn't about to rip on.
Red Ring is so last generation. Wow, you really, a lot of hatred in your heart for this. Makes me sad. Makes me really, really sad.
Yeah, the Red Ring is something you have to deal with, man. If you're a real Xbox fan, man, you deal with the Red Rings and you get them and then you
oh,
get
shit, a new dude. Elvis Aaron Presley, 1954, just followed us.
It's about time.
Is that his actual real middle name?
Elvis?
Yeah.
What were the numbers?
Elvis Aaron Presley, that's his real name. And 1954 would have been like right in his prime. Somebody really did their research on their sweet Elvis Presley moniker.
I'm pretty sure that's actually Elvis Presley.
No, it absolutely would have to. I knew he didn't die. And if you're Elvis, like, you're reliving the 50s anyways, right?
I was told he died pooping. Do you know anything about this? He died
Elvis
pooping.
Aaron Presley, 1954, says, I love Elvis.
Wait, he loves himself or he loves
Elvis? Right, it got really crazy there. Cabra Hunting says, fucking Italians, which I had to admin allow, I guess.
Yeah, man, it's a heavy thing to say without any context.
Prop Me Up Beside the Jukebox says, the king lives.
There he is. He's still pooping. Still dying on the pooper, bro.
That's what happens, right?
I don't know. I just remember, like, hearing as a kid that Elvis died, like, on the toilet. So I thought, oh, no, every single time I take a shit, I might die.
Yeah, Elvis Aaron Presley says, I have a jukebox.
Every song is his?
Yeah. I'm going to see if he keeps talking. This is kind of actually fun. Corey Adams' Rogue Thumb says he stroked out taking a shit. Elvis Presley then goes, shh.
Wait, is that Corey Adams' thumb not you?
No, I'm Corey Adam Comedy. I'm in the room still.
I thought you just made like a second account where you could just...
I have no idea who that is. I don't... Check it out. I don't have the knowledge or the care to create a second account. I barely created this account, Drew.
All right. Fair enough. Yo, I got a serious question. I just got like a capture card and whatnot. And I've seen like your videos of you like streaming The Witcher and whatnot. What kind of... I assume you've got a capture card as well, or do you just stream from...
No, whenever you see me on the games, that's just straight off the PS4. You just need like a $30 webcam and you're good to go.
Wow.
You could probably, I think Xbox is probably the same. Honestly, like all jokes aside, Xbox and PS4 are pretty similar. It's kind of garbage that you can't cross platform at this point, but whatever. But yeah, if you get their like regular webcam, it just plugs into YouTube and Twitch and it works real well.
Gotcha. Yeah, I just got a capture card so I can play like Switch and then start doing...
Cobra Hunting says, I stroke out while taking a shit sometimes. Elvis Presley says, it was a fat shit, okay? Like, listen.
Yo, I mean, I get it. Man, I feel like I'm going to die brushing my teeth half the time. If I have to spend any more time in the bathroom, I'm definitely dead.
Wait, what?
What?
Why do you feel like you're going to die when you brush your teeth?
I got sensitive gums.
Oh, yeah? Poor guy.
I think it's the smoking, man. I didn't smoke as much before moving out here, and all of a sudden I am smoking more, and my gums are really showing me that.
Like weed or just cigarettes?
Cigarettes. The weed out here might also be a fact because I just keep getting brick weed because I'm not getting any good weed because I'm in
balls. Why the fuck didn't you tell Zach to bring some up with him?
Man, I didn't even think about it. Like, I don't know, the lady friend I'm seeing currently, her dad has, like, a medical card, but he keeps getting brick weed, and she's out there in California, so she's picking up some real weed. I gotta answer this phone real quick.
All right, well, I'm gonna let you go, Drew. Have a good night.
Hey, man, I love you. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, we'll have you on again, man.
I appreciate it.
All right, buddy, later. Bye, Zach. Later. All right, that was... Two guys drunk in a hotel, I guess. Pretty fun. Pretty good. Where are we at? We're almost at time already. That's pretty cool. It was like a fat shit, okay? Elvis Presley said, did you see me? Like, I was chunky. And in 1954 is when Elvis released his first album. Oh, is that true? How the fuck would I know that? I didn't know that. I didn't realize that there would be so much fucking Elvis trivia on this episode. My bad, man. My fucking bad, all right? There was a link that I wanted to get to. This is kind of cool. This was an article on Reason, and this was about whether or not the lockdowns are a good thing or not. And this is interesting. Let's see. Yeah, so this is whether or not the lockdowns were a good thing. I like this a lot. Here we go.
Many Americans are losing patience with statewide shelter-in-place orders.
We don't have months or weeks. You know, businesses are hurting.
County Supervisor Jim Desmond has been fighting a losing battle to reopen businesses in San Diego.
Who's hurt the most in this are the poor people. The people that rent, the people that work in a hospitality sector, in the restaurant, a lot of single moms. We had our meeting the other day, we had people on the phone crying, saying, hey, I got a kid to feed.
Several southern states and Colorado have started lifting or significantly loosening orders.
When you close somebody's business down and take the livelihood, and they are literally at the face of losing everything, yeah. I'm willing to give them the benefit of the doubt.
Other governors are holding firm.
But if we pull back too quickly, those numbers will go through the roof.
Let's go from essential now, question not what is essential, but what is safe.
There's no date. If there's a date, then we're denying the facts on the ground. We're denying the reality of the spread of the virus, which is dynamic.
Have the lockdowns saved lives? There's a debate over how to analyze the data.
Lockdowns just don't alter behavior all that much.
Economist Lyman Stone says there's no correlation between the timing of statewide or regional shelter-in-place orders and a decline in the COVID-19 death rate.
We can basically build a theory and assert that the world obeys our theory and just go looking for any scrap of evidence that supports it. Or we can start by looking at What are the trends we actually observe?
Stone looked at the date governments such as France issued shelter-in-place orders compared to the total daily deaths 20 days later, the minimum amount of time it would take for exposure to the virus to lead to a death. In every case, he found the decline came long before the 20-day threshold. Lyman says that according to the data, voluntary social distancing is effective.
People were already socially distancing before the lockdown. Social distancing works. So we have a couple different data sources that basically track your cell phone, which is a little bit creepy. And what we can see is that policy choices like shelter-in-place orders had almost no impact on when people began to socially distance.
California was able to lower their caseload significantly and the number of deaths by quite a bit by putting this regulation in place.
Economist Andrew Friedson co-authored a working paper for the National Bureau of Economic Research that concluded California's lockdown was effective and may have prevented more than 1,600 COVID deaths.
California's location where this could have gotten really bad really quickly. Essentially, what we did is we took a weighted average of other states based on characteristics of those states that make them look like California. We looked at states that had similar growth rates to California and said, okay, of the states that did not put on a shelter-in-place order within a certain number of days, and then compare that to what happened in California.
The funny thing is that they find that their shelter-in-place order reduced deaths beginning 4 days after it was implemented, which means that you must assume that a considerable share of COVID cases die 4 days after infection. The problem is that's not even long enough for the incubation time.
In part, they're absolutely right that individual behavior and social distancing behavior started to change before these lockdowns changed. What the shelter-in-place orders did and what our paper estimates is that there's this additional bump that you get from forcing the part of the population that's not going to comply with the legal weight. What makes these numbers particularly slippery is that it's difficult to know how many of the job losses are temporary and come back when the disease is defeated or come back when the order is lifted. It's also unclear how many of these lives saved are just deaths that are delayed. I think the job of the economist is to tell you what the trade-off is, and then the job of the policymaker is to decide what them and their constituents are comfortable with.
Stone says what did likely flatten the curve was in fact information. Declaring public emergencies correlated with increased voluntary social distancing, and the closure of schools and cancellation of large gatherings also appear to have slowed the spread. He says that instead of shelter-in-place orders, the rest of the world should learn from the approach taken by Hong Kong, which never issued a shelter-in-place order and has just 4 documented COVID deaths.
We should not hesitate to pull the trigger on closing borders. Second, mask early, mask often. Everyone should wear a mask, and they should do so as soon as you know that you have a threat of a pandemic. Information is the most powerful tool getting people to understand the risk and protect themselves. But after that, centralized quarantine. Anyone who is a positive test, in any close contact of a positive test, we need to isolate them.
The majority of U.S. states have now significantly modified their shelter-in-place orders. Even California, which never came close to seeing its hospitals overrun, began allowing more retailers to reopen for curbside pickup on May 8th, but remains committed to a largely top-down technocratic approach.
Unfortunately, life comes with some risks. I think we're at a point, we're showing we're declining in numbers. To me, it looks like the goalposts keep moving back. You know, we shut these businesses down in a day. Why is it taking us so long to open them back up? I understand we want to be safe, we want to be prudent, but we need to start.
So that's an interesting thing to take. Whoa. TCB. It's interesting when they look at the numbers, and you know, one of the things we have talked about on this station over and over again is the lack of math and how we just don't really know what's going on. And if you are to believe experts, the experts don't really know what's going on. And so we can log all these parameters, we can have all this stuff that we want, but the reality is we don't really know what's going on. And that's as it gets better. But I'm glad states will open up that, like, you know, aren't us, I guess. Like, that's pretty rad, right? I mean, I don't know. I think that's pretty cool. The interesting thing will be to see what going forward is the complications. You know, like, how many of them really are just, you know, they come back or they don't, you know. because the workforce is going to be the real, I mean, the economy is the real threat. And all this stuff, it's always the economy. Where's that? Life is full of risks. Every human who's ever lived. Yeah, you're not wrong. It's full of risks. You're right. And it's less risk today than it ever has been, but it's still, yeah, it's still a risk. And that's, you know. Where is the rest? All right, here's what we're going to do. We'll look over where we have for time. We're doing pretty good. That's cool. Yeah, all right, we'll do that. We'll pop over to this. Whoops. Fuck that. There we go. Boom. Also, Penn said he's not going to self-quarantine. That's kind of funny. Fuck that, dude. Let's hit up Tovar. See what Tovar's up to, shall we? Here we go. What up, hombre?
Watching the show.
Yeah.
Enjoying my Sunday.
Yeah, which is really like your fucking, yeah, your Sunday night, right? Sunday is Sunday, because Monday you start up again. Or no, are you doing anything tomorrow or no?
No. I'm still a slacker. Oh, me and Brady are in talks to do a show, to do a co-hosting show. So, like, basically, I want to see if I can use StreamYard on Twitch. And I think I can. I just got to pay for that service.
Sure.
So. But yeah, just fucking hanging out. Watching that video is interesting to see the data on like when they locked down. I think
it's crazy crazy how they're like saying that the lockdown helped 4 days before it was implemented, right?
Right. Well, right, and like I think I've always kind of like said that laws don't actually save anybody's life. Like, of course, it makes sense that people were naturally going to distance regardless of what the state told them to do.
It was a scary time, and we didn't know what was going on. But there's,
right.
I mean, there's starting to be significant data, and if that's the case, theoretically, Sweden will start coming back and showing us that. But now, I mean, yesterday we were at 750. That's nothing.
Well. And I think what we are seeing a lot with these southern states is that the heat is actually starting to kill us. So like now that we're starting to come out of these colder months,
But it doesn't matter because right now we're locked in the political like battle of this pandemic, because now the Dems are going to sandbag it because they want to tank the economy down for the election, and the Republicans are just going to blame it on China to start an active war to up the economy if the Dems keep doing it.
Right. I'm still stuck in the middle. Like, I don't really know. Like, we had a good day today.
Seemed fine today. Like, is this Trump check still valid? I don't know what I'm supposed to say.
What's tomorrow going to look like? Like, you know, honestly, and what I saw, because I look at the map of Minnesota every day. And, like, so what I'm seeing right now is that, like, all of the rural areas are really starting to tick up. While the cities is kind of, like, maybe starting to plateau a little bit. So you might not see the numbers like grow as much as you did when it was like growing here in the Twin Cities, but like you're going to see a lot of these small town hospitals start to get overrun here in the next month or two here in Minnesota.
Oh, for sure.
Because like just between yesterday and today, like I can show you the pictures like after the show, like the color difference is crazy how much darker the map got in just one day.
On that John Hopkins site?
Yeah. Well, actually, I got the from NPR because, like, my mom texts me a map with all the Minnesota numbers on it every day. But yeah, I'm sure John Hopkins has a similar thing with Minnesota on it. You know, if you went and looked. But yeah, it was just showing all the counties in Minnesota and like how much darker it got. And
oh yeah, like, it's about to explode in the north. Yeah. I mean,
yeah. Well, not only in the north, but like the west of us too, you know, like all of those small counties to the west of us, to the southwest of us, like pretty much all of the Iron Range. I think there's like two or three counties left in Minnesota that aren't infected, and that's it.
Yeah, and I mean, we're still adding about 500 a day, but remember when I told you and everybody on the show that I thought it was an epidemic starting from New York and rolling the other way now?
No, and you can see that in a map. For
right, you can see it when you look at the map. You can totally see the pattern.
Yeah.
Yeah, and everything that was quote unquote first wave is just fucking not.
I think we're gonna come out of this like mid-June, right? We're gonna come out of this mid-June, and we're gonna have like some of the summer, and then like as the temperatures start dropping, we'll probably come back, and then it's gonna be like a really shitty winter.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. In conjunction with, you know, an election year. So, yippee-ki-yay, motherfuckers.
Yeah, it's going to be fucking crazy, right?
Yeah, man. Like, one of my friends in California was posting an article about how California is going to do all mail-in ballots for November. And I was just like, yep, there's a post office.
Yeah, I think you're spelling email wrong.
He's trying to sell everybody on how honest and like legitimate fucking mail-in ballots are.
Well, they are more secure, kind of, though. That's the weird thing.
Didn't they just find like over 20,000 in Wisconsin or something recently?
Yeah, but it's about micro hacking versus macro hacking. That's what it comes down to. Is that like if you hack a ballot box, you're affecting 20 million votes. If you hack somebody's mail, like literally like go out to a mailbox, take a ballot, like you're affecting one.
Right. But I mean, evidence has been shown that when it gets there, they just fucking pile them and then never count them.
Of course they do. I mean, I'm not. Hey, check it out. At no point do you think that I'm arguing that the system's fair and they don't cheat. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that, like, there's no. Like, I always thought it was weird that we didn't do mail in ballots anyways, because just the logic of it being a micro thing means that, like, because again, like, nobody's shaping, at least national. Statewide is a little different. But nobody is shaping a national election by mail ballot votes. That's just not happening. It's not feasible.
And what I think is really hilarious is that we can figure out whatever our like next television star, who the most popular American Idol is, in minutes. But like we still vote like it's the 1890s. So like standing outside of lines, and that's the other thing I don't get. Remember when like Wisconsin voted in their primaries and all those people were like standing outside? I never looked at the data and saw like the spike 20 days later.
The spike is hilarious, and it's like, what do you think you were gonna get? How is that gonna work out?
Yeah, man. I don't know. Fights last night were good. That's probably like the best fight I've seen in such a long fucking time.
Oh, it was great.
I feel bad that I missed your show last night talking about it. Yeah. It was good, man. It was something that was unexpected. I know you told me that you had bet on Gaethje, you know, and like I'd seen some of his other fights, but like, yeah, I was on the Tony Ferguson train for sure. It was just you just seen him like elbow the fuck out of people and mow through so many.
Yeah,
like,
but
fights.
Again, if you look at that, and I was talking with Chris about this.
I heard your case. I mean, you made a damn good case about it.
Well, and that's like, what I do when I bet money. I do a lot of research on people.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because I want to put in the smartest bet ever, and I'm telling you, I'm shoving money on him to beat Khabib.
Well, and I learned a long time ago that, like, when you make those long shots, like, you're probably about 80% on them. So, like, me calling you out, it doesn't really work because I'm going to be on the losing end of it most of the time.
Well, and that's the thing about long shot betting is, like, I'm going to lose more bets than I win, but the ones that I win will make me more money than if I just pick the favorites all the time.
I don't know what you do on the rest of, like, your sports betting and stuff, but it seems like on your UFC betting, you seem to do all right. Like, that Ronda, that Ronda thing that you got, you know, the Gaethje thing, like, you seem to clean up.
My whole thing is, like, when it comes to sports betting, like, specifically, I am of the mind that betting on the UFC is the easiest sports betting you can do. Because, fighting in general is the best sports bet because it's just a coin flip. No matter what the metrics are, it's 50-50.
Yeah,
you're getting 50-50 odds out of the gate just before you place it, right? And then you can improve the odds. I mean, like, what's really interesting about the Gaethje one is I almost put it all on him to win under two rounds because I thought he was going to win, but I thought his only path to victory was an early knockdown.
Rounds. Who'd have thought that fucking Ferguson's head was indestructible? Jesus fucking Christ.
Well, I mean, Gaethje lays down leather, too. I mean, like, that was like he was popping
there
a dislocated
so
finger
shots.
Back in.
It looked like, do you remember Mike Tyson's punch out when you hit Soda Popinski and his head would like whip back?
Yep.
That's what it looked like. It looked like his head was like whipping back.
You know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of, what's the guy that's the Indian guy with like the, he's wearing the turban and he does the phase out, phase in.
Oh, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
So Ball that guy, when he has a phase where he's blinking and you can't hurt him. And if you just uppercut him to the face, he doesn't even move. That's what Tony Ferguson was doing. You got any tips for us tonight?
No, man, I don't have any tips. I'm just drinking and having a good time.
So Wednesday you're doing a show then, or what?
Yeah, I'll have my show on this Wednesday.
All right, tell people where to find your Wednesday show.
I'll figure it out. Hey, come on, join me on Wednesday on Instagram, StephenTolbert79. I sit down for an hour with people, talk to them, bullshit, catch up. Friday with Friends is on Facebook. It's kind of like a green room situation, but it's kind of turned into the Brady and Me show, which I'm sort of fine with. It just shows me how much my friends suck, which I knew all the time.
All right, buddy. Yeah. Well, thanks. Thanks so much. I got to get running.
Yeah, man. Have fun.
All right. Later, buddy. Bye.
Bye.
That was Stephen Tovar. Don't forget to go to his Instagram on Wednesdays and Facebook on Fridays, and then something to be relaunched soon. All right. We're at that time. It's time to move into the end phase. Here we go. All right. Well, that's another one in the books. Thank you guys so much. Don't forget to Venmo and donate to Corey Adam Comedy. Everything you give does help me. It's not like I got money suddenly. I did not. Whoa, that's not the right one. That's the right one. Also, don't forget to follow and subscribe on all social medias. You guys have been awesome. This has been a good show. I guess we'll see you tomorrow, 7:30, same time-ish, same everything. You guys have been awesome. Thanks to everybody that joined us. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's it. I'm out of here. Have a great night. You are now microphone on the set. You can do supper fools anywhere.